101 Reasons, a journey into the twisted landscape of pop culture. Keep your hands and arms inside the podcast at all times. And now, the voice, Jeff Tucker.
All right, everybody, welcome to a very busy and full episode of 91 Reasons. I am the voice. I am Jeff Tucker. I am joined by a cantina full of people in my living room. It is a rainy Saturday night here in California. We have all spent the last day and a half absorbing Star Wars, The Force Awakens, and I invited everybody over to dissect it and talk about it. So what follows is going to be a huge spoiler-filled autopsy of The Force Awakens. So if you haven't seen the movie, what the hell are you doing listening to this episode? Because we are going to ruin it for you. But if you're a fan worth your salt, you've seen it twice already, like most of the people in this room. I've only seen it once. But we'll go around the room here, and it'll take you a while to figure out everybody's voice, but eventually you'll figure it all out. So we're going to go on to my left here, and
Shea Foley.
And Shea Foley, you're like a massive Star Wars fan.
Yeah, a little bit.
Massive.
Yeah.
You have your own Stormtrooper uniform.
I do.
And you're a member of the 501st. You have your own call sign.
Yeah, I do. I have my own trooper, I have a Boba, and I have a Jango.
Full. Movie quality.
Yep.
Not Jango Fett, by the way, just Jango.
Jango and Chang, right? What is your call sign?
TK5669.
So we'll just call you Tick. All right. So that guy laughing next to you is who?
Brian.
Now, Brian, we work together at Knott's Berry Farm.
Yes, we do.
And you are just as animated as I am doing movie reviews.
Yes, I am.
All right. So thank God you're here. All right. Glenn, go ahead. Who are you?
Glenn Schmidt.
What? Give us some credentials, man.
Credentials? Well, I have a movie review thing on Facebook and running my own business.
Yeah?
And an avid moviegoer.
You're a bigger Star Wars fan than I am because you, when the screening ended Thursday, sat through it again.
Yep, we saw the next show right away.
Yeah, and Shay's like, I was there a week waiting for that screening. Who are you? And you're joined by?
Julie Schmidt.
Now, you related to this guy? You know this guy?
I do, yeah.
All right, that's good. Thank God you're both here. It's weird. They arrived in separate cars. They're like, you're here, I'm here. Weird.
What a weird question.
So give us some credentials.
Credentials.
How big a geek are you?
Pretty big. Pretty big geek. Huge movie fan. Huge sci-fi fan. I hang out with Shay and Glenn, so I have to love Star Wars.
You kind of have to, right?
I kind of have to, yeah.
You know?
So, yeah.
All right. And over here?
Ruslan. I'm a huge Star Wars fan, and I could prove it by saying that I have a Star Wars Christmas tree in my room.
Nice.
Yeah.
Now, this is the first Star Wars movie you've seen in the theater.
Actually, that's not true. My first Star Wars movie was back in 2002 with Attack of the Clones, unfortunately. But I was too young to know how bad it was.
How old were you?
I think I was 6 or 7. It was my first ever movie in the theater.
Was Attack of the Clones.
Yes.
God, that's a rough, rough thing to have happen to a person.
I don't like sand.
You know what I mean? It's like, hey, I got my first car today, huh? Yeah, it was an Edsel. Damn.
Digital.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know, right? The Yoda.
All right. Hey,
you're right. And next to you, well, you're in the back there, ma'am. Who are you?
Colleen Tolley. I'm Ruslan's mom.
You're Ruslan's mom.
Yeah.
So you're to blame for that Attack of the Clones thing. But you redeemed yourself by taking him to see Force Awakens.
I did. Waited hours in line.
All right. That's a good mom. All right. Over here.
Luna. Skywalker.
Luna Skywalker. Yeah. I know, right? It's just so weird. They're like, Jeff, you must have loved Force Awakens. You're a Star Wars fan. So I named my son Skywalker. What do you want from me? Yes. And over there in the bunny ears.
Austin Tucker.
Yeah.
I used to sleep with a Jar Jar plushie.
Yes, 2 weeks ago, right? You slept with a Jar Jar plushie. Misa gonna go to bed with you.
We're gonna have words.
You were with a Jar Jar plushie. I slept with
it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I won that Jar Jar out of a claw machine.
Box, right?
I have pictures of them with it when they were like in their heartbeats. Like that was a
look. Can we? Can we?
Bin this big. Is like 10 of them.
No, you guys. He just said the Jar Jar was a good. A really amazing prize for a claw machine. No, around 2001 or two, there were plenty of applause plush Jar Jars to go around that they could fill whole claw machines with them, and guys would be like, hey, this one's easily winnable. Nah, I'm good. All right, ma'am?
Rachael.
The ma'am in the Yoda pajamas.
I love my jammies.
She's wearing green Yoda pajamas with ears that stick out past the sleeves.
I feel really soft.
That's right. Mmm. All right, and you, young lady?
I'm Josie.
Yeah? You're a big Star Wars fan?
No.
No? What was your reaction? What was your reaction when I said, you know, our friends waited overnight to get us these tickets. They waited all week to get a good space in line, and many Bothans died to get us into this screening. You said...
They're crazy.
Yeah. That's right. She's in line now for the My Little Pony movie coming. All right. And who are you, ma'am?
Hannah Love.
Hannah Love, yes. Yep. You're a big Star Wars fan?
Yeah.
Who's your favorite Star Wars character?
Probably Chewbacca.
Chewbacca. Ooh,
I didn't see that all the way around.
Did you hear the news today?
That would have been good.
What?
They finally showed the guy who played Chewbacca for most of the movie. Because I said, Peter Mayhew's not doing very well. But out of respect, they gave him top billing. And then finally, after the release, they showed the guy. And I'm like, oh, that's good. That's gentlemanly. I like that. And you're here with your mom?
Yeah.
And who are you?
Kristin Boaz.
Now, I've known you forever, right?
Over 20 years.
20 years. And how big a Star Wars fan are you?
Star Wars shaped the fabric of my life.
Oh, boy.
It's listen to that. Dramatic.
In what way? Like,
it was a constant happiness for me growing up and all the way through, even though there's been some real bad ones.
At the doctor's office, did you, like, when they're taking drawn blood, you're like, can I get the midichlorian count?
Yes.
The doctor's like, no, just sit there, Mrs. Boaz. Be quiet.
Yes. Right? I only choose...
It's an Indian doctor.
Yeah. I was going to say, who is this doctor?
It's an Indian doctor. It's Dr. Patel.
You know, Jeff, I go into a donut shop and I get cinnamon rolls. You
stick
know.
Them on your head?
Yeah.
All right. So everybody's here to talk about the massive Star Wars movie that was just released, The Force Awakens. And let's just go around, like, first initial thoughts. Shay?
I enjoyed it. I should preface this by saying I like everything, more or less.
Yeah.
I always find...
Well, I've always said, like, watching your Facebook posts and knowing you personally, the thing I say is, you and I both drank the Star Wars Kool-Aid early.
Oh,
you grabbed the pitcher, right?
I still have it.
I had a big glass, and I'm like, refills? They're like, Shay drank it all.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, no, I really enjoyed it. It felt closer to Star Wars than anything that we've had in a long time.
Yeah, well, really? George Lucas saw the movie 2 weeks ago before we did, and they asked him for his review, and he basically said, it's the movie the fans have been waiting for. And that was very telling, because that meant we were going to get really a familiar Star Wars movie.
Uh-huh.
And that's the thing. Somebody asked, like, a guy asked me at the post office today, it was my brother, I ran into him at the post office. He was like, so, how was the movie, man? And I was like, oh, well, you know, it felt like being spoon-fed familiarity. That's how I described it. Little spoonfuls of stuff you already like. Oh, I like that. How about another spoonful? Oh, I like that, too. Desert planet? Oh, I like that. You know, that kind of
thing.
Right.
I mean, to me, I mean, the whole movie's built on nostalgia.
Oh, absolutely. You know, no doubt.
I mean, every 20 minutes or so, you get a little hit.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, whether it be, you know, visually or from a music cue or something like that.
Scale of 1 to 10.
Ugh.
You're going to go high.
I'm totally going to go high.
Your wife said it was effing unbelievable, right?
I'd put it at a solid 8 for me.
A solid 8?
Yeah.
Not a 9 or a 10.
No, I mean...
So if Empire Strikes Back's a 10...
Empire will always be on top.
Yeah.
Up to this point. I would be amazed if anything...
They're never... No, they're not, because they're never going to give a director an opportunity to take a chance like that.
Right.
These are merchandise movies.
Oh, yeah.
And no one's going to screw that up.
BB-8.
BB-8.
You know,
yeah,
I mean,
and they sold more BB-8s in the last week than anything else.
Yeah, coming into it, I saw a couple of the reviews. Shouldn't say reviews, but more, you know, lists as far as rankings. And a lot of people were putting it right below Empire.
I wouldn't do that.
You know,
There's no way I'd place it that high.
No, I mean, to me, I would put it... it's hard because, you know, I mean, we're almost the same age, I think, you know, and those first three hit me at
the exact right age. Of course.
So it's hard to, I mean, it's hard to even compare them or to even rank this one within those.
Yeah.
But I think it's real close. I mean, I would say...
Well, it's designed that way, though.
Yeah, I mean,
to me... It's not by accident.
I'd put it level with Jedi. I'd put Empire, Star Wars, Jedi, and Force Awakens.
Brian, where do you stand on it?
If we're going to scale it 1 to 10, I'm right there. I'm about 7.58.
That's interesting. That high.
Yeah, I greatly enjoyed the movie. We already... right here. We had... I mean, it... To me, when I walked into the movie... The one big joke that I had made the entire time, like, before this movie came out was, I was like, if they take out the wipes, I'm walking out
of... Oh, there were more wipes than a box of tissues in this one, man. Lots of wipes.
I was so happy, because I was like, thank you.
It's Star funny. Wars. The first time it happened, I did the Flanders thing. I went, Star Wipe? You know what I mean? That's exactly what it was. But that's an aesthetic that you can't get rid of.
Exactly. And that's one of those things where they were like, this is going to be like the Star Wars for the new generation. And I'm like, that's awesome. And thinking about the person who directed it and everybody who's going to be in it, I'm like, that's great. But if I lose my wipes, I'm walking out. I can't do it.
That was the deal breaker for you?
Yeah. Well, we know what yours was.
I already said it. Too. If Hayden Christensen shows up on screen, I'm out.
It's game over.
I would rather see Jar Jar Binks. I would Hayden Christensen.
My goodness, he's a Sith Lord. I'm sorry. I had to do
Jar Jar?
It.
Oh, stop. That's so stupid.
Conspiracy.
I hate that revisionist crap. That's like your mom serving up 10 pounds of leftovers and going, no, I've made something amazing out of it. No, you didn't, Ma. Listen, this is the same crap we've had for years.
It was so funny,
no, it's
though.
Chicken surprise. No, no, Jar Jar's a Sith Lord.
It was so funny.
Come on.
But yeah, all in all, basically what I tell people, like, when people come to me and ask me, should I, like, what did you think about that movie? No spoilers. What I say is, go see it. I didn't feel like I wasted my money.
All right. Glenn, what's your thoughts? You saw it twice in one night.
Yeah, I thought it was good. It's a solid 7 for me on the scale, you know. I mean, there was a few things I didn't like or would have rather seen, and there was a lot of stuff in there that was nostalgic, but I like the nostalgia part. But like you said, it does seem like they're just kind of feeding you what you want, you know.
Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, nothing wrong with that.
When you go to a buffet in Vegas, there's going to be stuff you've never tried, but the majority of, there's a hamburger and they got a carving station. Yeah. Oh, okay, and this is all stuff I like. Yeah. That's what it is.
Yeah, I mean, I thought the writing was kind of basic because he kind of used the same kind of hits as the other ones, you know. Here's the bad guy in a mask and, you know,
Yeah.
But other than that, I mean, I enjoyed it.
Yeah. Julie, what do you think?
I would give it a solid 8.
Okay, you're higher than Glenn. Yeah. That's good.
I cried every time we saw one of the original characters come on screen.
Yeah.
Pretty emotional.
Yeah. Well, for me, like, the nostalgia factor was amped up. Like, it was great seeing Han and Chewie, but the minute Han and Chewie and Leia were in the same frame, I was like swimming in like, these are my friends. Look at them, you know. Well, they're old. It was like a high school reunion for me, you know.
Absolutely.
You know.
So I liked it a lot.
All right.
I enjoyed it.
Ruslan, you're chomping at the bit over there.
Well, at first I gave it a 10 out of 10.
10 out of 10.
Whoa!
But then I went down one and gave it a 9 just because there were some flaws that I found out that the further I thought about the movie, but nothing that ruined it. But anyway, I thought it was a really great movie. It was worth the 2-hour wait.
How old are you?
19.
This movie is aimed squarely at you.
Yeah,
young people with disposable income, because it's not a movie. It's a lifestyle.
Exactly.
And I know this because for us old guys, it was sold as a lifestyle.
Yeah.
You know, when you went to the store and your mom, you were like, Legos. No. You collect Star Wars.
Exactly.
Your aisle is over here.
I collected action figures.
Yeah, but like, this was there was nothing like it before. I mean, you could maybe Beatlemania before, but when Star Wars landed, this was breakfast Star Wars out of my cereal bowl with a spoon, and lunch in my lunch box, right? And dinner was like glass of milk with blue food coloring in it. Everybody did this. And when you went to bed in your Star Wars sheets with your Star Wars blanket, looking at your Star Wars figures, the next morning it started all over again. And you were counting the days until your Star Wars birthday party.
Yeah. That sounds like yesterday for me.
But also that's the reason. That's a really good reason why, like, Lucasfilm and Star Wars in general being bought by Disney is a good idea, because they're about building lifestyle.
Oh yeah, no doubt. There was no doubt that Disney looked at it and said, look, we've got the girls wrapped up with Princess and Tinkerbell, and we're going to put Marvel here. What's the next thing? Because Cars, they got to put movies out to sell cars. Mm-hmm. Star Wars. But it was the perfect... We all knew that, because you can't have a franchise like Star Wars and Lucas just let it sit.
Yeah.
Just let it sit. He had, remember there were going to be 100 TV shows?
Uh-huh.
And like, oh, no, we're waiting for all the scripts to get written, and now, like, George, what are you doing? You could hire 10 people and have a Star Wars show in production next week.
Yeah.
There should be a movie in production every 3 years like James Bond. Mm-hmm. But he didn't do that. So, no, I think the Disney thing, buying them, was a good thing as far as, you know, feeding the beast.
Yeah.
Colleen, any thoughts?
I loved it.
Yeah, you had a good time.
Fantastic. But, you know, I remember when the first one came out. But, yeah, I loved it. I didn't have any expectations. I just went in and enjoyed it for what it was. And I was not disappointed.
There you go. Well, that's all you can say about a movie.
I like that there was a lot of teasers, a lot of cliffhangers. They really left me wanting more.
It's a setup.
Yeah. Very animal cliffhanger. And
yeah.
I started laughing, but yeah.
Well, we'll get into that in a minute. That's when things will erupt.
Yeah.
we're just getting to know each other now. Luna?
Like a 6 or a 7.
6 or a 7? That's high for you. I thought you'd be a lot lower.
I like the universe of it. I like all the new characters. I like the actors were great. It's just the script was terrible and needed like 2 or 3 more rewrites before it was like a part where they could have started shooting. Mm-hmm. There were too many logical flaws.
I always say in a movie that has problems, paper's cheap. Mm-hmm. Just write a few more pages before you
there
hit the set.
Too much plot problems for how much time they had to make this.
All right, Austin?
This movie is the Swiss cheese of Star Wars. It has so many plot holes in it. I give it a 4.5.
Four and a half stars.
4.5.
Wow.
Is half of it. I feel like they spent so much time on designing these beautiful aliens, these beautiful costumes, these talented actors, and they wasted all their time with a movie that wasn't nearly that good. Imagine what these people could have been doing if it wasn't on this film. A film that could have been a masterpiece if, like Luna said, it had a few more rewrites.
All right. Mm-hmm. Hannah?
It's potential.
You want to jump in on this? Rachael, why don't you go first?
Yeah. Okay.
Rachael?
I give it an 8 just on a movie all around, and I give it a 10 on... Solo.
We should say that we saw this at a theater where the seats recline, which I knew Rachael was in trouble, and she nodded off one time.
Let's not talk about. It's the only part of the movie I would have been mad about. I think my new go to sleep.
She nodded off at the bridge scene.
Okay. I saw the bridge. Oh, someone's fallen off that. And then I saw him like go down and call the name. And I saw.
Yeah.
And then I woke up because everyone was screaming. Like Jeff was like huffing and puffing because they killed him. And I'm like, I missed it.
Yeah.
They killed him. I said,
this is
oh my
but
God.
This is movie going with Rachael. You know, Rachel's like Rosebud's a what?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Rachel's like Bruce Willis.
You know what,
could he help that little kid with the ghost?
That stands alone to why I gave the movie an 8, because I fell asleep for 2 minutes of that whole movie, and that theater had the most comfortable chairs ever. So that I was able to stay awake and fight those chairs stands alone.
You needed that Polar Express chair that dug you in the back every time you reach an angle.
No, I didn't need it for this movie because I really enjoyed it.
All right.
Even so,
I didn't like that.
That's a moment where if you're tired, you sober up real quick or something like that, you know.
Moment.
Josie?
I gave it an 8.5. I really liked it.
Which is odd, because you didn't even want to go.
See,
you didn't want to go.
No, the Tucker.
You didn't want to go to the movie. Yes. What'd you think of the new girl, Rey, the girl power in the movie?
I honestly don't really care about her.
No?
She's not a girl touch on her.
Yeah.
All right.
I think she just should have spent the whole movie staring at the camera going, I'm not Keira Knightley. Oh my God. Right? I'm not Keira Knightley. Is that Keira Knightley? Did they make this a few years ago?
That would be really great if, like, if when she's at the front of the line, she gets her rations, she leaves, he looks at the next person in line and goes, Keira Knightley?
Yeah, right. Keira Knightley was in Phantom Menace, so it all circles up. Hannah, you ready?
Yeah, I'd probably give it an 8.
8?
Yeah.
You look like you'd give it higher. You're like, yeah, Star Wars!
Well, yeah, but,
And Chewbacca finally had a moment.
Solo, right? Yeah. You have to go down a point for that alone.
Yeah.
Even if I slept through it and didn't see it happen.
You can't go like, down a point because like, they killed off a guy?
Yeah, I did. Yes, it's an 8, not a 9 because of
that. I
was
going to make it a 9, but see? I decided to go to 8.5.
For the same reason.
Han Solo.
Yes,
she gave Schindler's List a negative 400. And I'm like, why? She was because they killed everybody.
The problem is they didn't kill Han. They just left fake drama.
Now you had... Wait. Don't get in this yet. Let me finish the round table yet. He's over there like to throw a grenade at me.
Yeah, I was like, you were talking about chomping at the bit. Yes. He's about to leave the table.
It's Hannah's floor.
Well, I really like the jokes like that they said in the movie about like Chewbacca and all that stuff.
Yeah, there was a lot more humor in this than any Star Wars movie.
I also really like the story of Kylo Ren. Like, the background story and stuff.
Yeah, well, what we got of it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wish there was more.
Yeah.
All right, Boaz, Kristin?
I gave it, like, a 5.5.
Ooh!
Wow. Are you serious?
Zing!
She's been waiting for that.
Why?
I said it was fire!
Let's go! Wait, let's go!
It's her table.
I liked it.
Okay, I did like it. I enjoy almost just, like, my new friend over here. I go to the movies, and I mostly enjoy every movie because it's entertainment. It's rare when I walk out. And I enjoyed this movie. It was enjoyable seeing my old friends back and seeing all that, but there were too many holes in the script. There was no character development between Han and Kylo Ren to justify what happened, and I didn't give a Yankees when that happened. I'm like, I feel very angry because I don't care. Because they meet and that's it. And there's no build up.
Yeah.
It's not like it took two movies to get to that
like
point.
Emotional.
It just went boom, we meet. Oh, bye. It wasn't after that, I couldn't wrap my head around the fact that happened so quickly. And how
Whitley.
The writers,
sorry,
how the writers were able to allow that to happen, like that was a mistake. I felt that was a deal breaker for me.
All right, so we'll open the floor up, and I'll just start it off by saying, any Star Wars fan knew it, worth his salt knew Han was going.
Yeah,
because he's done every interview. Harrison Ford's a famous curmudgeon who hates talking to people. We watched him on what show where he ripped that Han Solo doll apart?
Was it Jimmy Fallon?
He ripped that Hot Toys $400 Han Solo apart, and we're all like, don't do anything. And what was hard to watch about it was the guy wasn't kidding. He was really angry at that doll. It wasn't a bit. Because a bit is you de-pants him or something, and he, like, destroyed the doll. So we all knew Han was going. Han wanted... Harrison wanted Han to go in Return of the Jedi.
Mm-hmm.
He said he's got nothing
to
live for.
He wanted to go through the vampire.
Yeah, that's why he's frozen in carbonite. Yeah. Because if the contract wasn't signed, Han stays frozen in carbonite and is dead forever. So we get all that. We knew Han was going to go. And we also knew, reading between the lines, that Luke wasn't going to be in the movie. He ain't on the poster.
He had no life.
His name is there, but we know, like, there's something... I mean, it was way too obvious. Yeah. He didn't make the rounds. Even Rachael asked me, like, why isn't Mark Hamill on all the talk shows? I said, because he's in it 2 years from now. He'll make all the rounds 2 years from now because they didn't... What can he say about the movie?
Yeah.
Right.
Well, how was it making the movie, Mark? Well, it was a good day.
Yeah. It was cold up on the mountain.
It was sure. Yes.
I think you're being generous with the day.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Right.
So, all right. So we're gonna open it up as long as we don't, you know, as a cacophony talk over each other. But we'll just open it up to this film. I didn't give my number. Let me give my number. I'm gonna give it two numbers. I'm going to cheat and say, as a remake of A New Hope, it was a 9. Because they nailed New Hope every beat by beat. Yes. As a movie on its own, it was like a 5, maybe. Mm-hmm. Because it bathed in nostalgia. For the people who didn't, like, us fogies, we didn't watch Star Wars. We absorbed it. We breathed it in through our pores. I know every frame of A New Hope, right?
Yeah.
Every frame, every nuance. And so, at watching Force Awakens, I just kept going, I know what's going to happen next. Because they're just following the formula. But how are they going to get off Jakku? Because if they get off Jakku, it has to be with the Falcon. Because that's what they got off Tatooine. Oh, there's the Falcon! They're getting off the desert planet in the Falcon! Are you kidding me?
Why didn't they say where the Falcon came from?
They did.
It was a little bit of dialogue.
But like Han Solo going, it went from this... He was like 2 seconds, he explains it. And it's not explained at all. It's just...
Because they're probably going to write a book or something on it.
Yeah, I
was, No, you can't. That, okay.
No extended.
Here it is. The blanket statement is, you cannot justify an argument by saying there's a comic book, soundtrack listing, or novel. No. We adhere to the red letter media. It's either on the screen or it didn't happen. If they talk about it, then it happened. But if, like, well, it was in the novel, The Force Awakens prequel. No. Okay, so off the bat, who the hell is Max von Sydow playing?
Yes, that's what I wanted to know.
They hinted that this was...
They didn't say anything.
What? Okay, I'm going to steal from my friend Gus, who said, if he had said, oh, I'm Wedge, we would have all went, oh, hell yeah. Or just get Wedge. He's still alive.
Yeah.
Because putting Max von Sydow in a big cameo like that, you have to tell us who it is. And you can't... I mean, if they just go, thank you, General Popopi, we got the thing, right? That's fine. But for him to go, you... What did he say? You are an important person in this story that we won't mention. What the hell happened there?
Well, that's one of the things. They don't develop any of the characters.
No.
Really.
No.
There's no, like, character there it is, development.
Off you go, you know.
That's what cost my five.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what just, broke
there's no
me.
There's no background on anybody.
No. You're dropped in the middle and expected to just catch up.
Yeah, I mean, my only thinking is, because in difference from Star Wars, where Star Wars truly at the origin was a standalone, this isn't.
No, no. And I listen, we've done it to ourselves by paying all this money for these Marvel Cinematic Universe movies where, like, Iron Man 2, 2-hour commercial for the Avengers. And I left the theater angry. Like, there was hardly any story here. What the hell am I watching? And of course, I mean, it's a cookie cutter. You give the audience just enough to call it a movie so that 2 years from now you can go, all your questions will be answered. No. I gave you $20.
Yeah.
I want some answers now. I want to know who Ren's parents are. Now, you guys have seen it twice.
Yeah.
What I got out of it, she's Luke Skywalker's kid.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Without a doubt.
There's no doubt.
No doubt, right?
No doubt.
But let me ask you this, and we're just going to start this off, right? If she's Luke Skywalker's kid, because she touches the lightsaber and gets a vision, right? Yeah.
Mind you, the vision being like, if you blink, you miss it. It was the shortest vision you could ever see.
I was fine with that.
You blink and you miss what's going on.
I was fine with that.
I need proof on this. I read that when Steve gets the vision, there are clips of the prequels
with
Ian McGregor as Obi-Wan.
Just the voice. But yes.
Oh, yeah, no, there was some weirdness in there, right?
Yoda, yeah.
Yoda.
But you see, but there's a moment where you see Luke, because you see Luke's hand on R2,
yes.
And you see baby toddler Rey being delivered to Jakku, and you see Kylo Ren.
Yes.
No.
Go back to the snow.
But wait, no.
It's like a foreshadowing. Was
it a foreshadow or a flashback?
No, it was a flashback.
Flashback to the snow?
I think that was...
How does the math add up?
They've seen what was going to happen.
Yeah, they showed the battle that
was going
to happen.
And they've been doing that since Anakin.
Yeah. They flashed back, and then they...
Okay,
because
it's a hodgepodge. She
was a mess.
She has, well, yes. Well, first of all, I'm okay with how short it was because I don't give a shit about your flashback. Oops. I don't give a crap about your flashback.
I needed the flashback because it's getting
correcting
something.
Correcting it doesn't take it out.
Something. We need something to go off of.
Yeah, not yet.
So we're just jumping around. We're then told that, the beginning of the movie is Luke Skywalker has vanished.
Yeah.
How long has he been missing? Do we ever find that out?
No, we don't.
No.
They say it's the moment that Kylo Ren did the thing in the flashback. Not an exact date, but
they don't give you a date.
He had already grown and was already wearing the mask. So, yeah.
So
it's been recent.
20 years. 25 years? How old is Kylo Ren? 28?
Kylo's in his mid-20s.
Early 20s.
Yeah. So like 10 years max, maybe.
At most.
Yeah.
So Luke's been gone 10 years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So in 10 years, nobody knows where he went or anything, right?
No.
So Luke's gone. He's gone to, what did they say, to the first Jedi Temple? I heard that, right?
The original Jedi
Temple. That was a rumor. Right?
That was a rumor. Yeah. Because the truth is he went to Ireland, and it was so obviously, so obviously
Ireland. He's in the Isle of Skye.
It just was so funny when they cut to that. I'm like, oh my God. It's like, he's got some Irish Spring going on, right?
Yeah.
It was so silly.
Funny.
My God.
I'm sorry. For me personally, just like when you were saying that you needed more, just like you needed more out of the Vision, I needed way less of her climbing a mountain.
Yeah. Yeah.
That went on for
way too long. I'll put my hand up and say I needed 30 minutes less of Rey, period. Because she has no story arc.
Yeah.
That's the problem. There's more story and character development in Luke Skywalker staring at the suns than there was in the entirety of Rey's time span, because I don't know what this chick's deal is. Who does she live with? Who raised her? We don't know anything. She's just having lunch by an AT-AT. We're supposed to go, oh, it's an AT-AT. I recognize that. Then she puts on an X-Wing fighter pilot helmet. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't have been the only one who thought, boy, she could have got like 6 loaves of bread for that helmet.
No, you were the only one who thought about that.
If that's the currency, come on!
I was like, oh, is that supposed to make us think about her dad, you know?
I thought she was going to fly X-Wing later.
You know?
Yeah. No, no, she's not a pilot.
But she is with the Falcons.
Yeah. I was like,
oh, is she a pilot?
I was like, what do you mean she's not a pilot?
I don't know.
What movie did you watch?
I don't know.
See?
Whoa, did you see one?
I got nothing out of it.
Oh my God, Tucker went into Krampus. I was like, what is this?
For 2 minutes, too.
What's that?
I think you fell asleep for a couple.
I know.
Too.
I fell asleep mentally.
She's never driven anything other than a speeder, and then she did the.
Well, she drives that big fudgesicle thing that flies. It's a fudgesicle.
It's a flash drive.
It has a window.
It has a little.
Why does it have a little windshield? Who is that for? Her hands? I don't understand. Yeah, my other question is: how long have the Star Destroyers and everything been crashed there?
So,
29
years.
29
years.
Given the battle
of okay, so we actually have a number, 29 years. Now, if you park a Plymouth at Pick Apart, in 2 weeks, there's nothing left on it. So in 29 years, there's still stuff that she can like, oh, this is going to be worth some credits. And like, wait a minute. Yeah. And let me say, I don't know what that character was that was buying that crap
that
from her. That was the worst character I've ever seen in a Star Wars movie. He was worse than the Yuzum that sings in Jedi Rocks. He was worse than in Bo Sheck. You name it. Like, what a dumb looking character.
Okay, the junk dealer or the food guy from Phantom Menace? Which one do you like more?
They're both bad, but I mean, it's the food guy's like, Daiwanawanga, you're going to pay for that. And this guy's just like, here's the credits. Stupid. And let me ask you this. They got ships that can pierce hyperspace and take you, because spoiler alert, at the end of the movie when they finally find the map to Luke, they get there in like 2 minutes.
Yeah.
They just needed the coordinates.
Right?
Oh my God.
He's right around the corner.
Did we not want the whole movie to be about the search for Luke Skywalker?
Yeah.
Like, wouldn't that have been a better movie?
Yes.
Because what's the plot of this movie? In a nutshell.
Because it felt like three plots.
What's the plot? In New Hope, Luke Skywalker leaves his farm life to fight the bad guys and save the day. I just described Star Wars.
Yeah.
Right? And that could be the whole entirety of three movies.
Yeah.
But the plot of this one, I don't know what the plot of this one is, and it's tough.
Like, there's three plots going on. One about Rey, one about Finn, one about Kylo, and the thing with the search for Luke added in between.
That should have been the search for Luke. And you know what? They gave you the perfect opportunity to put a plot in here. Because I'll tell you, I for one, when Han Solo, like we talked about earlier, when Han Solo goes, are you kidding? Another Death Star?
Yeah.
Everybody in the whole audience was like, oh my God.
Yeah, how long did it take to build that?
Well, who paid for it?
Right.
Here's the problem I have with this movie, is that it drops you in the middle of the universe and says that in three movies, we watch the ragtag fleet of rebels fight the ultimately superior forces of the Empire. And through pluck, moxie, and little teddy bears, they defeated them and blew everybody up. And then what happened? They didn't assume power. Because Leia and everybody are still hiding in bunkers while the Emperor, the Empire, has all these uniforms and weapons. We will prevail. Who's funding this? I have to ask. Because they were... In Heir to the Empire is... This is the Timothy Zahn trilogy that takes place after Return of the Jedi that really brought Star Wars back. The Empire is scattered to the winds. And it's up to, like... individual Star Destroyer captains, Admiral Thrawn, to unite them and go, look, we can take back the galaxy. This one drops you in and goes, oh, they're back in power. No, which no. negates the entire first trilogy.
People have tried yes. to do maps, and they, like, they're only in power in a little section, and the Rebellion has the rest.
But it doesn't matter, because they got a gun that can shoot across the sky.
Yeah.
I'm a bit confused.
The Death Star had to know where they were and go there. This one, they just go, well, Google Maps will tell us where they are. They're here.
I understand they were really against government scenes, because the prequels took that to no end. But from what I'm getting, there's a Rebel Alliance, there's a Resistance Alliance, there's a New Republic we didn't even hear about.
How yeah, no, we saw them on the railing, like, go, oh, and then they were blown up.
We never got to explain who's in control of what. Is the Rebel Alliance just a tiny...
Well, here's the thing, though, Austin. Here's the thing, Austin. That's what the crawl is for. The crawl is supposed to open up and go, the Rebel Republic has fallen. They couldn't sustain their government, and they allowed the Empire to rise up. You know, because the Empire is the Third Reich. You don't allow the Third Reich to come back. You squash them like a bug. And there's that guy, I mean, in Third Reich with the blonde hair and everything going, you know what I mean? Yeah. It looked just like a Nazi propaganda film. It's supposed to, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So they've got all this technology. And here's what I was talking about. They got a weapon that's how many times bigger than the Death Star?
Plenty.
A lot.
Ten.
And it can suck the energy out of a star and then redirect it as a laser blast.
And star killer.
It just sounds too much work.
Why doesn't it just destroy sun?
Why doesn't it just go to a system and go, look, if you don't bow to us, we're going to suck the sun dry. Right. And then the...
It takes too long.
Then they suck the... Well, then it takes a while. Then the people are like... Ugh! And then they're in power.
Well, this does it at a distance. It does it at a distance, so you don't have to go there.
But it launches in the...
right. Well, can we just say that the scene where Rey collapsed into Kylo's arms was right out of Spaceballs, and he's carried in the ship?
Yes!
I was like, oh my god, that's Spaceballs! Anyways, so they've got all this technology, and I know that movies work a certain way. And the example I'll give is, in modern day movies, the hero's cell phone always has to be disabled because anything that happens can be solved with a couple of phone calls. If John McClane had a cell phone in Nakatomi Tower, they don't ever steal the money.
Right.
One phone call, it's over, right? So they have to have shorthand and ways to fix things. But my question is, they're using a flash drive? Like the whole movie is about a flash drive that they put in BB-8?
Yeah.
Okay, that's mine. I'm sorry. I'm taking BB. Okay.
He's been waiting for a BB. Now, okay, BB-8. We've seen for a long time. He's been introduced as he's the new R2-D2. Little did we know that R2 wouldn't even be in the movie.
Yeah.
Like it wasn't.
Yeah, he is. He's in it as long as Luke is.
Yeah, but
which
it's
is
not
so important.
But it's not like
he's more lines of dialogue.
That's true.
But it's not like you get to like we did. Like who do you like better, Luke or Han? Gee, I don't know. They're both cool. This one is like you don't get to like R2 because he's under a tarp.
Yeah.
He's under a tarp. Well, imagine now, before you get to BB-8, but just imagine. Imagine, like, Luke leaves. He's like, look, I've got to go. And we'll get to that in a second. Luke leaves, and R2's like, so sad, he shuts down. So what do? They just throw a tarp over him.
That was messed
up.
Just
put a tarp on him.
And R2's the one that knows everything.
Yeah, he knows everything.
Everything.
Yeah.
He's always known everything.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And that's the reason why... That is the thing that annoys me so much about BB. It's that people are... Like, he's been compared to R2 up until this movie came out, and I swear to God, I've been saying for a while, I was like, what if they just blow him up in 20 minutes? In like 20 minutes of the movie.
Oh,
like,
no.
What if at the beginning, when he's like, run as fast as you can.
And BB-8 gets blown up.
Kylo just looks at him and goes, dead. Like, I would...
No, really Brian, hard. That fate was reserved for the character hyped more than anybody in this movie, Captain Phasma. I watched an interview with J.J. Abrams, who said, we were going to kill Captain Phasma off, but Gwendolyn Christie, she just played her with such finesse and grace, and I'm like, Win!
Yes!
Yeah. Oh my god. There hasn't been a character this underused since Boba Fett.
That's what I think.
That's a good analogy. Yeah.
And are you joking?
Well, and that's the thing. That's just analogy. Like Boba Fett, that's BB-8 really has been marketed like crazy for this movie.
For the
but more
there's
so...
There's a huge hurdle, Brian, in this movie in that Star Wars is for guy geeks.
Mm-hmm.
And the most amazing thing that Disney did is you got women walking around with Star Wars purses. Mm-hmm. And BB-8 wallets, and I see more women sporting Star Wars stuff than men.
Oh yeah,
and that's a huge win. And you can trace that. You can trace that to BB-8 being cute and orange because that's a very popular color.
Yes, but more so than that, the thing that annoys me so much about this movie is that he was so much hyped up as the new droid, as the new R2-D2.
Well, yeah,
R2-D2 is a badass. When you send off R2-D2 by himself, he's gonna, number one, he's gonna, like, anything that's going on inside of your space station, he will most likely ruin it and be able to take care of it for you.
Yeah.
Hey, R2, I need you to do this.
Done.
Cool. I'll do that. Not only will I do that, anybody who sees me is gonna get wrecked on, and then I'm gonna
yeah,
do
but
it.
Yeah, but BB-8 can shoot out cables.
Yeah, and BB-8... yeah.
Why did he never
BB-8... Yes.
He can shoot out cables.
BB-8 can give you a thumbs up with a lighter.
Right. Yeah, I definitely thought that was a middle finger.
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah.
He's the cool one now.
My favorite,
he's the new R2.
My favorite BB-8 scene
R2 has two full flamethrowers.
No, those were deactivated. My favorite BB-8 scene is when Rey is slowly descending into the basement.
Oh,
and behind, yeah, you can hear
BB-8
him
like,
clunk, clunk, clunk. And I was like, you know what? I applaud them for doing that.
Yes.
Because those of us who've studied the movie know whenever R2 gets up to something he can't possibly overcome, they just cut away. Like, the Royal Starship's got a lip 3 feet wide, and R2 rolls up to it, and they go, well, we're leaving now. And R2's already on the ship. You're like, how did he do that?
But more so than that, I loved the fact that you could actually see BB struggling with the steps. Like, he would look down like, oh, Jesus, there's another one.
Yeah.
But more so than that, I was talking to somebody about BB-8, and they were like, what don't you like about BB-8? Just like when people ask, what don't you like about Bing Bong? I can sum it up real quickly. BB-8 is a glorified map holder, and then once they take the map from him, he's an empty map holder.
Well, even so much as when R2 comes alive with the map, BB-8's like, oh, I gotta go get the map.
Yes. And you're like, wait a minute, hard drive.
You didn't download a copy like all of us did? And they actually have to show like the thing. That's for all the dummies in the audience. And then BB-8 comes back and it's like, ooh, the puzzle. It was the map of Tannis coming together, you know?
Yeah. For
British,
oh. They even had the music in the background.
Yeah.
We have all these characters like BB-8 and Captain Phasma. Who are marketed so much and get so little screen time.
Yeah.
Because the film has so
that's what they do. But understand, though, merchandise and stuff has to be done before the movie is made.
From a plot point view, we have all these characters that get little short segments, like Mars, for example. Who's the main character of this movie? It's the same problem as Phantom Menace.
I feel like who's it's
the
right.
Main the main character of this movie, the only one who has a story arc is Kylo Ren.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
At the end of the movie, only one person has changed, Kylo Ren.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because he's now killed his dad, fulfilled his prophecy, injured himself so he can put on Darth Vader armor.
Yeah.
That's all they've been building towards.
But you know, he was knocked out in the snow. Why wasn't he thrown into the boiling lava that was next to him? That way he could really become Darth Vader.
Well, he should have been crawling towards it, you know, and then... Snoke or whatever the hell his name is, like no.
Well, they made him a tough guy by him beating on his own wound.
Yeah, that was so dumb. But I thought they were gonna build towards something.
I know.
You know,
was
he was like doing a McConaughey.
The one thing that I will say that I was interested in.
That
would have been badass.
But the one thing that I was interested about with Kylo Ren was the fact that in the way that I compare it, and feel free to be like when it comes to the way that they show the dark side and how it evolves in people, the only way that we have actually seen it evolve in somebody still in training is with Anakin, and it's with somebody who is strong with the dark side being taught by Jedi.
Whereas with Kylo, it's the dark side inside of him going unchecked by the people training him because of how strong he is with the dark side. And so what you see is all of that rape. P.S. Oh my god, the section where he goes in, realizes Rai is gone, and then starts destroying everything, and the two stormtroopers are like...
Temper tantrums?
Yeah. Oh, no. The stormtrooper's like, he's at it again.
I died. When they just like stop, they're like...
No. Yes,
and that's...
And he needed to be put on
and
that was
the funniest part. And so that's
we saw...
But here's the thing, like, that...
That was the funniest part.
The boy needs to be put on extinction.
Yeah.
But it's like, that part of... Like, the dark side, it's the same thing that Anakin did when he destroyed everybody after his mother died.
Yes.
Like, it was the temper tantrum. Yes. That's what you see when it goes unchecked. Mm. Yeah. Like, so to me, that was interesting.
But it happened twice. I'm like, okay, once? All right. They're doing it again? Okay, what's the point?
Yes.
Well, and then they didn't answer the point.
They showed us that he had Darth Vader's helmet, that he was praying to it.
Yes.
Now, when he dropped his helmet...
It's Vader's ashes.
Those were Vader's ashes. That's what I wanted to ask, because I only saw it once. That's creepy.
Absolutely.
Yeah. They should have explored that. So imagine, he goes to Endor and he's, scraping it up, and the Ewoks are, watching him from the forest. You know, that would have been... Go ahead.
When he drops his helmet,
it's in a box.
It's in a box of ashes.
It's Vader's ashes.
Been there after 15 years.
I missed that one.
Well, it would be, They used to sell us dirt from Dracula's grave in Fangoria and Starlog. So if you say it is, it is. Yes. Yeah. What were you going to say, Glenn?
Well, you mean it's not?
The stormtroopers, I mean, are they assumed that they're clones? Are they still clones?
No.
Because
they actually touch on that.
They explain it.
Here's what I'll say.
Because I was sitting there going, why isn't anybody know that guy's a stormtrooper?
When Finn escapes, Kylo Ren says, this is why we should use clones again. Yeah.
Here's what I would say.
I missed that one.
Yeah. Here's my pitch. The better movie for this is the rebels, the resistance. What are they?
The resistance.
The resistance. That's from V.
Yes, that's what I said.
The better movie is the resistance going. They're doing what? And Leia going. We're going to launch an initiative to the planet where they kidnap all these children and we're going to free them all. That's the movie I want to see, is all the kids that are being trained to be stormtroopers, and then the good guys show up, and they're releasing them. Why wouldn't they do that?
I mean, anything but
a Death Star. Anything but a Death Star is all I ask. Empire didn't have a super weapon, and it's a brilliant movie. You don't need it. You need the machinations of family. This is about the Skywalker family and their offshoots. So the whole plot should have been Han, I got this kid. Let me tell you about him.
Yeah.
You know, and his name was Ben, right?
Yeah.
That was Ben.
Ben.
We needed
Ben
something.
Solo.
Yeah. Ben Solo.
It's just nothing.
Here's another one. Why isn't Leia a Jedi by now? That's another.
Well, they've said in interviews that... Luke concentrated on the new generation, and she became a general and sort of blocked all that.
Yeah, she just backed off.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so big questions for you guys.
Well, she even says, going back to that, she even kind of touches on it when Solo talks about them splitting. He's like, I went back to what I was good at, and she said, so did I.
Yeah, and I'll buy that. Because knowing what we know from the prequels, Jedi's not cut out forever. Not everybody's cut out to be a Jedi. There's a lot of baggage that goes along with it.
A problem. Why didn't Princess Leia have more of a problem when Han Solo did not come back?
Well, no. What did we say? You could take that shot of the movie and overdub.
But she hugs a new Chewie. That's not what we want.
She runs past Chewie.
Or give it to Chewie, not the new chick. We needed something more purple.
Right. You could overdub it and have the person on the outside go, hey, we're out of eggs.
That was
the reaction that we got.
Right.
Oh, yeah. About what I figured.
My moment of dying was better than her moment of him dying.
There was no remorse. It didn't seem like it was just her,
When Han died.
Too fast.
When Han falls off the bridge, right?
Yeah.
When Chewbacca just suits Kylo Ren, how come Chewbacca doesn't jump on the blades and whip Kylo Ren's arms?
He could have.
He should have
jumped down and died doing it.
I was going to say, because he's holding a lightsaber.
That's his long life partner,
I don't know how
Chewie
got out of that movie alive.
Chewie's standing there, he shoots Kylo Ren, and he goes, Chewie, hand's dead. Well, my life debt's over. Back to my family. And Chewie just walks off, right?
Yeah,
okay, so
back to the Star Wars Christmas special.
Yes.
Great!
I have questions, and I need you guys' help on these big questions.
No problem.
When did the Jedi learn how to mind meld?
When did the Jedi learn Force lightning? Doesn't matter when they learned it. They learned it.
No, I don't buy that. Here's why I don't. I have a reason. I won't just bent blanket say no. Kylo Ren is presented to us as a guy who couldn't quite grasp the Jedi ways. That's why he's got temper tantrums and wears a helmet even though he needs it. He thinks if you go to Hot Topic and buy all that stuff, you're a rebel. You can't buy Rebellion at the mall.
Right, and didn't he like make his own lightsaber?
Wait, well, yeah.
Very similar. Like he fashioned it himself.
Yeah. Exactly.
It's very. It's not. It doesn't look like someone handed it down to him. No. It looks like he put that together because he couldn't quite, you know.
This weapon is your life, you know. But like, it would have helped out a lot of times in the other movies to mind meld and like just take their thoughts. And like, as cool as it was when he froze Poe Dameron and froze Poe Dameron's laser bolt, I thought that was great.
Yes. Yeah,
but so I just kept saying, cool. When did they learn this? Yeah. Just tell us. Well, you know, I've delved into the dark side farther than anybody. Done! I got it. Done. That would have been great.
Just a couple lines.
At all in the finale battle.
Somebody has to
at all.
Teach
any moment he could have done that and just like walked away.
Well, he did. He froze Rey for like a second, right? Yeah. She pulled a gun on him and he froze her.
Yeah.
The other question is, Ben Kenobi hands Luke Skywalker his father's lightsaber and Luke goes, wow, gee willikers, look at this. Yeah. Rey picks it up and she can like, she's like, it's like baking soda. She knows every meal that it's had in over 30 years. When did this happen?
I don't feel. One of the interesting things for me watching this movie, because of course this movie is there to set up other movies. The interesting thing for me was when I watched the battle between Rey and Kylo, I was like, this looks real dirty. Like, it doesn't look choreographed. It looks slapdash.
Oh,
it does not look.
They wanted that. That was on purpose.
Exactly.
Because they wanted to avoid Phantom Menace.
What they want to do is see a development of these two Jedi. You want to see them get stronger. You want to see a development into what you saw as a lightsaber battle in the third movie, which was great to watch. And this one was really not. It looked like they were both not ready to be doing this right now. And I liked
that. That's because neither one of them had training.
Exactly.
Yeah. It makes it look instinctual.
Exactly. And that's what I liked about that battle.
Okay. So what does it say about Luke Skywalker that one student sort of has a bad day and he's like, well, I'm out of here. And he just literally runs away.
Because it was his nephew.
No, it negates Luke Skywalker. Luke Skywalker's the most honest, hardworking guy in the universe, and he's already seen what happens when Ben Kenobi goes, well, now I gotta go into hiding and I'm out of here. He would never, never have done that. And Lawrence Kasdan knows better, because he knows these characters better than anybody. And I wish we just would have had somebody, if they're gonna sit down and talk, somebody sit down and go, well, I was with Luke when he made the call. What happened? Here's what happened. Here's my take on it. The little chick with the orange slice eyes? I wanted her to say that.
Yeah.
Like, all of a sudden, she's got Luke's lightsaber? Yeah. Are you joking?
I want the story behind that.
Yeah.
That's a long story. She even said that. That's another story.
I'm like, you know what? We all got time.
Yeah.
So you cut to Luke on the gantry and his hand getting cut off, and we follow it all the way down, and we just keep following it through. You know, it lands somewhere, and you know, somebody's ship, and then it lands on someone, and it rolls off, and this guy picks it up and pawns it here, and then it's pawned there, and then finally she gets it, and she goes, oh, I know what this is. She puts it in the box. Right. Done.
Yeah.
That's what we want to see. Yeah. We're only getting the end result of 30 years of missing time. It's frustrating, because I love these characters. Mm-hmm. Han Solo is my uncle. Luke Skywalker's my brother. I want to live with these guys. And the idea that they're like spoon-feeding.
I'm okay with that. Oh.
Okay with what?
Yes, you said that out loud.
Yes. You're like the crazy person.
Okay, with what?
It was very nice.
Yeah, but it still has to be a two-hour movie.
No, I totally get that. And it harkened back to me... the Kevin J. Anderson novels of the early 90s. Kevin J. Anderson wrote like 30 Star Wars novels. And I read the first five until I figured out what his formula was. And the formula is you've got an old character, Admiral Ackbar, General Maydeen. You've got a new character, and the old character gets incapacitated, and the new character has to rise up and save the day. And then we like the new character, because not only did they defeat the bad guy, but they saved Admiral Ackbar. That's what it was. And Rey is like, I'm going to save this and that. But they didn't save Han Solo, so I don't know what you're going to do. Yes, you know, just jump in here.
All right. About the whole thing with Luke, you know, bailing the whole Jedi Order and the new Jedi Order and stuff. I kind of, in my own certain point of view.
Well, most of the truths we cling to are from a certain point of view.
Yeah, you saw what I did there. I think
everybody did this one.
Yeah. I think this is how I took it. Is I think he was ashamed because he failed training Ben Solo. Not only was he ashamed of himself and, you know, not wanting to show his face to, you know, his two best friends, his sister and his best friend Han Solo, but also I felt like he let Yoda and Obi-Wan down. I think, you know, he's like, I failed what you've taught me.
But could there be more to that?
An interesting thing
I heard at work today was you're forgetting the fact that Luke defied the Jedi way and had a kid.
Yeah.
Who did he have a kid with?
Yes.
And
was that Ray the kid?
Yeah. So
Where's mama?
Did he have that weird thing where we've all had that moment of, gosh, I'm too old for this party.
Yeah.
Kylo Ren's doing stuff I can't even imagine, and I don't want to be a part of it. And just leave. What were you gonna say, Shay?
Well, you know, I think part of the thing with Luke, I don't think it's just Kylo, because you know they talk about the Knights of Ren. I think everybody that Luke had under his tutelage basically bailed on him. Basically took on, you know, fell under Kylo and left.
Now if Kylo had like a round table of bad Jedi,
that would have been fantastic. Is him with all those guys around him.
Yeah.
I think that's the Knights of Ren.
That would have been great.
So my thinking is, I think it's less of Luke sort of bailing because he feels like he failed. Or I wonder if it's more... He feels that any connection that he may still have with the dark side, however slight, is what caused that.
To
drift.
That's so brilliant. He's
pulling himself away from it
away from everybody
that's force sensitive. And same thing with Rey. That's why he sends Rey off, is because he doesn't want that dark side to sort of infiltrate anybody that's force sensitive.
Now, he's already seen himself lose.
As beautiful as the Emerald Isle was at the end shot, especially that stupid Fantasy Island shot where it's going around and you can see the ocean going really fast. I hated that shot. What if the movie had ended differently? What if Rey, like, first off, if you're going to send Rey to get Luke, you got to explain why you're sending Rey and not Princess Leia,
right?
His sister. Oh, you've got the coordinates? Send the stranger. You right? That's the moment where she goes, why are you sending me? You're his daughter. You're the only one that's going to be able to convince him. And it's like, oh my. Then she's probably the ship going, I'm going to meet my dad. Oh my God. Because she says in the beginning, I've been waiting for my family. These are missed opportunities. But imagine they take that, and I wanted that scene to be longer. I wanted them to stop somewhere, and like they're at a bar, and some guy's yelling about, oh, the coordinates have changed. And then there's another shot, like a road trip. Not just, we're here, bing, yeah. We're here. A road trip. Later. And then, here's what I wanted. And I know you got to review the movie you got, not the movie you wanted. But imagine if at the end, that Falcon had taken a shot and landed. And when she comes down the gantryway, she's looking at Yoda's house.
Yes!
Yeah.
And Luke lives there. And why did Yoda live on Dagobah? Because that dark force tree negated his good force energy. There was a reason Yoda lived like that. When he lived there, no one could sense him in the galaxy. You imagine if, like, Luke comes out and he's in Yoda's house? That's what we wanted. Cool. If you're going to bathe in nostalgia, man, give it to us.
Yes.
That house is real tiny.
Yeah. But he fit in there.
He fit in there, but he was all crouched down.
But imagine, like, if you saw...
He's sleeping in Yoda's bed. It's like this big.
But what better place for Luke to feel at home? Yes. In his master's house.
You're not wrong.
Or differently. It lands, she walks out, and it's Ben's house on Tatooine. Mm-hmm. And he's, because, I mean, he looks like Ben. He's the same age as Alec Guinness. And he comes out, and, I mean, imagine you're there, and he's bought his land speeder back, and it's parked. Mm-hmm. I mean, that would have been like, nostalgia overkill.
Yeah,
so
if they wanted to do nostalgia, they could have done.
I get their things, you know. Yeah. I think they're gonna treat it like James Bond. Like remember in Skyfall, he opens the garage and there's the Aston Martin. Like I think Luke's gonna pull off the sheet of his X-wing, you know. Yeah. It's just, you know.
One of the things that you harped on early on, when you said why wouldn't they send Leia and instead send this girl?
Yeah.
Sending the girl is whatever. She's the character in the movie. There's plenty of reasons why they didn't send Leia. Number one, she's been a general for how long? How long has she been outside of battle? There's no way that you could send an old lady to do a young lady's job. I'm sorry.
The job is to convince somebody to come back. You send the one that can have the most guilt.
And that's not Han.
Your mother would do that.
Well, Han's dead.
Well, yeah, I mean, now.
Moms are good at that. You know what I thought?
Exactly, right?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So let's go around and just, real quick, favorite moment of the movie, Shay?
Oh.
Favorite moment. Because we've been delving into all this minutiae. Let's get back to the reason why it's so good. At the end of the day, it's still Star Wars. It's still better than Transformers or Kung Fu Panda 3 or any other crap that fills the... Or Inside Out.
Jack Black is a masterpiece, okay?
Of what? He's a piece, all right. I saw the whole audience laughing at chitty chat chat chitty, and I'm just sitting there going, "Why is this funny? Is there something wrong with me? Because I don't think this is funny, and everybody's laughing."
I had the same exact
right? Chat chat chitty, and I'm like, I don't get it.
Hey Jeff.
You get
real quick before we get on to our favorite part.
Yeah.
I just want to say the two things that I wished would have happened when Rey met, the three things actually, just to make it real brief, when Rey saw Luke Skywalker. I thought it would have been great if Luke turned around, you know, took off his hood and says, just redo the line of saying, the Force is strong in my family, I have it, my sister has it, my father has it, you have it too.
Yeah.
Or I thought it would have been awesome, too, if he says, I've been expecting you, Ray. Let's begin your training.
Right. Or if he just turned and had the saber float to his hand.
Or
how about this? How about she goes, I mean, because we want dialogue at the end. Yeah. The wordless crap's for the birds, right?
True.
You know, how about, are you Luke Skywalker? And he goes, that's a name I haven't gone by in a long time.
Name.
We would have all left the theater in tears.
Yes! Thanks, they want to go nostalgic.
JJ, you can hire me. Yeah. I can come in and work on this crap. Like, that's what we want. I know that, we have to balance it between the nostalgia and the new. No. Some things are okay. Some things are okay, man. You can go back to the classics. There's a reason James Bond fires the gun at the camera, because that's what we want. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. It's okay to do all that. They didn't have a problem with the Death Star or the Stormtroopers or... before we get into that, I wanted Captain Phasma to be so bad because of that armor, and I love that chick from Game of Thrones. She's a great actress. Like, all of that, and I just wanted a moment where Finn goes, you're going to give us those codes to the shield, and she goes, are you joking? I've been trained to die before I'll give you that.
Yeah,
that's what I wanted.
They seem to get her real easy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, way too easy. Yeah, he was cracking jokes.
Yeah.
I mean, this is basically, who's Hitler's right-hand man? Himmler. It's Himmler, right? That's the name of the general. Like, this is who this is. This is the leader of the SS, for God's sake. Mm-hmm. This person would rather die than give you any information. There should have been something. I don't know. I don't know. Maybe after the scene we saw, he goes and he takes her helmet away, which is all her strength. Because what did she? The only line she really has is, "I want you to put that helmet back on."
Why did you take off your helmet?
Right, yeah. Put it back on. That helmet is you. Well, I'm taking your helmet. Yeah. I don't know.
Something. Give us something. Some kind of meat.
I want. I just want her to be bad.
Yeah. If you're gonna go there with the beautiful costume and the voice, just give us something to see.
Well, I don't know why there wasn't an action scene of showing her as a badass.
Yeah.
Like showing a whole squadron of troops dying, and she's just.
They Boba Fetted her.
There's too much.
Like Finn fought that guy with the hook. Thingy on his arm?
Yeah.
Why wasn't that Phasma?
That would have been great.
Right?
Because they Boba Fetted her.
Yeah. Well, less is more, right?
I was just saying.
They're saving her for the next one or whatever.
For the next one?
I thought Lando should have shown up at the end with the Rebels.
Can you imagine how him and Chewie would react seeing Han Solo die?
Well, I don't think you needed that because, I mean, that would have been, to me, too much reaction is too much reaction.
Yeah, I know.
But like at the end when she goes, we're sending you to send Luke. Well, who's going to pilot the ship? That's my problem, right? Oh, hey, yeah, it's Lando. Ooh, yeah. Tears. You know, like, come on. And then in the back, you see, like, Lobot carrying his luggage. You know, it would have been great, right? This, you could. Yeah. I mean, Luke left it. Luna left the theater going, I thought we were going to see Dengar.
You're going to go so much to nostalgia. Well, that scene where, what's his name? Poe Dameron, is that his name?
Yeah.
When Poe leans down and he gets the flash drive. Like, they're trying to say, we're homaging Star Wars. All right, fine. Okay, I get it. Yes, you're copying the movie one for one. But if Admiral Akbar is on screen and he gets no dialogue, then you failed.
He said one or two things, but he didn't go. He didn't say it was a trap or anything.
He didn't say it's a trap.
Yeah, no.
That's
Arnold going, I'll be back. Yeah. You can't have that. All right. Let's have some happy. Enough nitpicking. We'll get.
No sidebars.
We got a microphone here. No sidebars. We'll get to it. We'll get back to the nitpicking.
But I wouldn't have pressed you. She just asked me who the guy is with the little thingies, and I said, Nine Up. I knew that.
Okay.
He didn't fly in and take part in the destruction of Starkiller.
Or was he wearing white?
I didn't like that they didn't give our classic characters.
They can't be a slave to Lucas. They have to put in the new stuff. I get all that. I mean, you guys are aware that the Disneyland land that they're building...
It's all new. I mean,
But the planet that they're doing it wasn't even in the movie.
Right.
I thought, it's good. It's not the one in the movie. I don't understand.
It's a planet nobody's ever seen.
What the heck?
It'd be a future.
Oh, yeah,
how about that?
Yeah, it'll show up.
Just wait till we done when the movie's actually
right.
Exactly.
Favorite part of the movie. And you can have two. I mean, whatever. It's a bowl of popcorn. What'd you like the best?
I mean, the easy thing to say is anytime we saw somebody that we knew.
Sure.
Anytime they came on screen, whether it be a human or a ship. I mean,
did you think Han was going to go, where are my dice? I thought he was going to go, who took my dice? But it was something else, right?
I totally did.
Yeah, I really did.
Honestly, I would say the part that actually was, that hit me most emotionally, I mean, aside from the given, was the crawl.
Yeah.
Was seeing Luke Skywalker's name in the crawl.
Yeah.
Although,
was it just me, or was there an audible groan when it said Luke Skywalker has vanished? The audience went, oh. Oh, that's not what the movie's going to... Oh, you're kidding. I mean, I was almost like, let's get out of here. There's no Luke in this movie. I'm an unabashed... Luke is my guy. Luke's my favorite character. I didn't want to play with Luke. I wanted to be Luke Skywalker.
I mean, watching it, I knew... Well, I shouldn't say I knew, but I had a feeling going in that we wouldn't see him until probably the last episode.
Oh, yeah, I knew too, because of the way it was advertised.
About halfway through, I'm like... We're not going to see him we're going to see him for 3 minutes.
Yeah, or less.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yours is just any time there was like a Han Solo, Princess
it's
Leia.
It's the nostalgia thing. You know, the music he was coming up when the character just came on screen. Yeah, I mean, of course.
I thought a couple of times near the end, I was like, every time like Ray looks at the camera, they're like, na, 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 na. And I was like, oh my God. You could almost see John Williams going, here we go, ding, 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 na, 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 na. Like, oh, come on, man.
We can talk about the score later.
Yeah. Okay, Brian, what was your favorite?
My favorite...
Your favorite scene's not in there. It's where they dismantle BB-8.
Hopefully. I mean, from
we have been without a protocol droid.
Shaq comes, takes him, and makes a three.
Yeah! Oh, dude, they're remaking Shaq food. Anyway, no. Different podcast. No, I would say that my favorite part of the movie... You see, it's not necessarily a part of the movie... But more so, I was actually excited about how much I liked the character of Kylo Ren. Not as a super badass,
I know what you're saying.
Like a really strong person.
It's what we said earlier.
As somebody who was flawed and,
it's natural.
Not complete.
It's natural because he's the only guy with a story.
Yeah, exactly.
He's the only guy with an arc.
And like... If I was to pick specific parts of the movie, I would say the part of the movie where he's trying to get stuff out of her mind and then she reverses it on him and is like, you're afraid you're never going to be as strong as Darth Vader, and he like
like, it completely breaks him in a second. And I was like, ooh, sickness! Like, I was really, happy about that. Because I was like, it's showing, it's more so, it's like, it's kind of like showing the strength between these two people. Like, because you always want to see, like, a, like, it's really interesting, like, to see two characters that are kind of equally strong get stronger and stronger and see who ends up being the strongest. As opposed to like a Darth Vader Luke thing where it's like, I'm already up here. You got to get to my level.
Yeah.
It's,
that's why the battle between Ben and Vader at the end of New Hope is so good. Cause it's two guys
at
having an elegant fight.
Exactly.
You know, with manners.
Yeah. They're already at the top.
As opposed to the cord on the cob. They're spinning and dipping and flipping. And I don't know what's going on.
Yeah. But like, it's, that's what I liked about it is that you know that you're going to see a development of these two people on, who are sort of on the same level on.
But didn't you want in that moment for him to go, oh my God, we're cousins?
No.
I did. I totally did. They're related.
You know why? Because I don't give a crap about your family, Dad.
No, they're part of the same gene pool.
I don't care. I'd rather watch you fight than.
Or maybe he leans in and kisses her.
Oh God, no.
And you get a Back to the Future moment where she's like, it's like I'm kissing my brother.
Ah, gross. Right. No, I don't want that. Kiss. I was like, it's Luke and Leia.
Further. Oh yeah, what? No, but the or like, hey, we're family. Skywalkers always make out. Let's go, sweetheart.
Oh my right? God.
Did you get to the rebel base? No, second base.
No. But like being able to see like the start of that is really interesting because like for me, I've played video games my entire life. Like I grew up being her age and playing Pokemon, and you start off with Ash and Gary. They're at the same thing, and you just watch them both build on the opposite sides of each other and see who becomes the strongest.
I have no idea what the hell you're talking about.
And that's fine, because that part's not for you.
I'm way too old.
Again, and that's fine, because that old. Part's not
Pokemon.
For you. Pokemon. Fight me on Pokemon, dude.
I wouldn't even know how to play.
Exactly.
All right, Glenn, what was your favorite sequence?
I mean, besides the nostalgia stuff and the humor and everything, which is good, I kind of like the battle scene with the Millennium Falcon, because it seemed like the most kind of old Star Wars-ish.
I was shocked that after seeing that scene in the trailer,
yeah,
you're talking about on Jakku, mm-hmm.
Yeah,
escape,
yeah.
It wasn't Han piloting it.
Yeah, I did
too. The moment when it went into that dive, I was like, oh, that's not Han doing that.
Yeah.
No, I don't know if I like it as much. I'm a little biased.
I mean, I like the action shot, but I thought it was kind of dumb. It's like, oh, let's go take the garbage mobile. Oh, it's the most famous ship in the galaxy that still works.
I know,
it's
right?
Garbage.
That's the part I had. Right? Like, we've only been 30 years since the events of Return of the Jedi when that ship liberated the entire galaxy.
Yeah.
And now it's like, oh, we don't even know what that is. Yeah. Are you joking? It'd be like Kennedy's car. We'd all know Kennedy's car on sight, no matter what age we are.
Luke's saber wasn't in a museum. What do you want?
I don't know. Maybe some reverence. And not just accidental coincidence, like, we need to get off Jakku. Well, how about that ship? Blows up? Well, we'll take the second one. The Millennium Falcon. You know what I mean? Oh, my God.
Yeah, the only part that they get that as far as legend and stuff is, you know, her going, oh, I've heard of Luke. I thought he was a myth or whatever.
Did you love that the Falcon's gunner, they didn't change it?
Yeah.
It had the same graphics.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
those were the kind of things. I mean, I thought that the turning on the chessboard was stupid. Like, oh, remember this? Or when he holds up the training ball.
Ha ha! So funny.
How is that still there?
I just, he's so almost funny. Like he was going to go, huh? Wink, wink?
I think just like winking at the old schoolers that are here you go. Here's some nostalgia for you.
But here's the thing. It's like, we talked about what's acceptable and what's not. The tracking thing for shooting down the TIE fighters was fantastic. Because I remember that scene. Mm-hmm. It's one of my favorite scenes.
Yeah.
That's enough. I don't need to be. I don't need a walking tour of the Falcon. I mean, what was he going to put on the helmet with the blast shield down and like?
It's still hanging on the wall.
Was it? Oh yeah, my God! Yeah. I'm joking.
Yeah, it's still on the wall.
So it goes through multiple owners, but nobody cleans up the place.
The dice.
Where are the dice, man?
Okay, so you're mad about the dice missing, but when they find the test ball, they're like, why is that?
Why is that there?
It's because it's not nice, bro.
Yeah. Julie, what'd you like?
R2 is my favorite character, so I like when we see him and then when he wakes up and
I thought that was
the action.
I thought that was really cute.
That
I mean,
emotional.
Who doesn't love R2, right?
BBA fans.
I like R2. I'll always like R2.
Because he's. I'm sorry.
I just didn't care for like putting a sheet over him.
He's a robot that never talks and everyone loves him because he's awesome. He's awesome. He's hilarious with no words.
Well, here's what I have to say. Nitpicky thing. We went through six movies where when R2 talks, we need a translator droid or Luke's little X-Wing thing. And BB-8, she's like, mm-hmm, yeah, uh-huh, oh yeah, left? All right, let's go. What do you say? Well, he said this. Like, you speak BB-8? Yeah. That should be acknowledged.
Why droids speak English?
I mean, yeah, no, just, hell, just you know, turn a switch on.
But I wonder if that's part of her forceness. You know what I mean?
Oh, I hope not.
Gets everything
that's
what
I thought.
Wait, I was going to say,
because she
when they're in the trash compactor, yeah, Luke is talking to R2.
It led me to believe that.
No, he's talking to 3PO. Shut down all the garbage masters on the attention level. Shut them all down!
No, you know what?
Anakin could talk to protocol.
Well,
right, yeah. Sorry, built
no, but he says... He has a translator thing in his ship.
Yeah.
Does he?
They never just talk back and forth. Does Obi-Wan on Kamino talk to R2? No. R2's not even on Kamino.
No, R2's not.
That's a red one. Yeah. But, you know, they it's always explained somehow. Mm-hmm. Like, offshoot. I always thought that Cyclops and the X-Men should just be able to shoot lasers when he wants. But they always make a point of, like, him touching his temple. Like, wouldn't you come up with something that runs on your eyes and your thoughts? They got a ship that can decloak and all this stuff. So, again, why not just flip the switch so that the R2 unit... Because, I mean, wouldn't the guy go, look, we could save a lot of money on droids if we just make these talk. Ruslan, favorite part?
I have to say that my favorite scene in the film was when that one simple scene was when Leia and Han hug each other. That
was a good scene. Right. Look at you. Yeah. Look, going to the old school stuff. I love that. That's cute. Yeah. I love it.
Well, I grew solid. Up with the old. Well, not I grew up with the old school stuff because of my mom bought me the VHS of the original trilogy.
What's VHS?
I still know what that is.
I still have mine.
Yeah, mine are right over there.
Whether he wanted to or not.
That's right.
Like Star Wars.
Yeah.
Hey,
good mom.
Could have been worse. You could have got a sports figure parent.
I had an 8-track player in my bedroom.
All right, so Luna, what'd you like?
I was gonna say when they used the gunner in the Falcon.
It was great, right?
Yeah.
And that there was a learning curve on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like he didn't just like. No, it's like you gotta figure it out.
But for new stuff, it was the like 5 minutes that Finn and Poe were actually together, and there were two actual main characters.
Now, okay, let's.
'Cause after they broke up. There was no main character.
Let's figure that out. If we take Rey out of the movie completely, and it's the Finn and Poe Dameron movie, it's a better movie, right?
It's a great movie.
It's a buddy flick. It's a buddy flick of two guys joining the rebellion and hanging out.
Oh, it would have been so good. And I think that's my main problem is I wanted to like this movie so badly. And when it started out, I was having so much fun.
So what was your favorite part of the movie, you hated?
I liked Maz.
The credits.
You liked the Maz character.
Yeah.
The little Yoda chick.
Yep.
Yeah. I liked her too.
But like,
I did too.
Why did we switch protagonists?
Now, we're not getting into that. Colleen, favorite scene?
I loved the scene where Rey was able to mind talk to the stormtrooper and make him...
Yeah. You've heard who that was, right?
The first time, he's like, whatever. And then she's like, all right, I gotta work
that. Was James Bond.
And then when she did that, I was like, oh, that's...
Yeah, I love how he dropped his gun. And that was part of the comedy of it. I thought all that was pretty good.
Yeah, there was a lot of comedy, and I really enjoyed that.
But that was also flipping the script, because now the princess literally rescues herself.
Yeah.
And I'm okay with that. Yeah. I don't have any problem with that.
That was the whole first time using the Force scene. It's just the Wampa Cave, but just in a different location.
Oh, yeah. And did we all notice the subtleness of the lightsaber in the snow?
I thought Luke was going to show up there.
Oh, yeah.
I would have bought it.
I thought it was going to go right past Rey and Luke.
Right in his hand. That would have been great, right?
I thought they're going to get Rey in a vulnerable position. And just as he's about to finish her off, Luke's going to step in.
Just like Vader does in Jedi.
That would have been incredible. Yeah. Right. That would have been awesome.
Rachel, favorite scene of the movie?
And I mean, how would you feel if Luke Skywalker said something like, she has no... I'm having drawing a blank here. She has no interest to you now. I am.
Yeah. Rachel, favorite scene of the movie?
Every scene with Han.
Han Solo.
There we go.
Every scene
minus one.
And I'll tell you.
I'm
looking forward to him in the sequel.
Can I tell you the most favorite scene that I should have got? Was the kiss with Princess Leia.
Yeah, no, they didn't kiss. I really wanted that too.
That wasn't enough.
We I don't care that they're old.
I just wanted her.
There was no kiss in the movie.
Yeah. I just wanted her to say, I don't know. Something. Anything.
Yeah. I wanted that too. I've missed you. I know.
Yeah. Yeah.
That would have been great, yeah. Right?
I thought that was coming.
Why don't they put some stuff there like, can't do that. You know.
I don't think they want to overdo this.
I was going to say, I mean, yes. They could have instead taken some other nostalgia stuff out and put that in.
Yeah.
Yes. But at that point, it would have been.
Hannah, favorite scene?
I kind of had two.
You throw them out.
Okay. Well, the one was a humor scene where Finn and Han were talking to each other, and he's like, "So what was your department and stuff?" And he was like, "Sanitation."
Yeah.
So, and that made me laugh. Like,
yeah, that was fun.
Yeah, and then Chewie got cold and stuff.
Chewie got cold.
Yeah. And then I also like when Rey kind of used the mind trick on her clone.
Yeah, that was a good scene.
Yeah.
Kristin?
I had a couple, but I had some sound favorite stuff, like when I heard the TIE fighters, sound.
Yeah.
Hard, my heart started thumping. But I love Adam Driver. I think he's a fantastic actor. I just love everything he does. And so any of the scenes where his helmet was off and I was actually watching him act was interesting to me, and I wanted to see more of that. Like, I like him a lot. I think he is an interesting choice for the movie, and I'm interested to see more what he's going to have to do in the next one. I think he's a great actor, so those were good scenes.
All right.
I got a hypothetical.
Yes.
What do you think that Han is not dead?
Oh, he's dead.
He's dead.
Well, I'm sure he probably is.
He fell down a pit, and then they blew it up.
Yeah, he's gone.
He fell down. What happens after? Hey, Luke fell down too, but he lived.
Yeah, but he didn't fall down on something that blew up.
Eventually, he did blow up like that, and
Can't we come back to the flashback or something in a dream or something?
Hold on, you guys, it has to be one at a time, or we can't understand you.
Darth Maul survived far worse.
Touche.
Not in the movie, he didn't.
I think he's coming back as a dream or flashback or something.
Yeah, I think it's flashback. But the hypothetical is, what if Han isn't dead?
Well, I mean, they could bring him back. You know, they flash back to a scene where he falls into something and winds up, taking him away or whatever.
Robot, Force heal.
What if Mace Windu's the new Yoda? What if?
I would take all that because you're talking, the big hurdle is Harrison Ford doesn't want to be in the movie. Well, if you can get past that hurdle, I would buy almost anything. It's Harrison Ford, arguably the actor of our generation. The guy who was in Star Wars, Indiana Jones, Blade Runner, are you kidding?
Yeah.
That's a pedigree nobody else can touch. And if they showed a scene where he slams into the earth and is crawling and gets up on a ship and flies away, holding himself, I'll buy it in a heartbeat.
Yeah.
If he goes, look, he put a sword in me. Well, sure he did, and it carterized all the way through, and now I got a hole.
Yeah. That's
I'm okay with it. Are you kidding?
Yeah.
If they had a thing at the end, like, okay, it's happened before. They muddle through the entire dead man's chest of Pirates of the Caribbean. At the very end, Captain Barbossa goes, "What have you done to my ship?" If they did that in this one, are you kidding? I'd be on my feet. Oh, yeah, he's back.
That might make sense.
If everything looked bleak, like in A New Hope, and they're like, "Well, we're done. We have no way out of it. Yahoo, blow this thing, kid, and we're all out of here." And it's Han Solo? Oh, it'd be a... That's a crowd pleaser.
It might make sense because there wasn't enough.
They did that Poe in the movie already.
True Poe.
The exact thing. He flew down in his ship and saved the day.
Okay, let's talk about Poe Dameron for a second. We haven't even mentioned him at all.
We actually really haven't. How did we not do that?
Exactly.
Nobody cares.
He's superfluous. He's the wedge of this movie.
He's the good looking one.
He's the subject of the worst line of dialogue in the whole movie.
Which is?
Anybody know what I'm talking about? Oh, is Finn going, "That's a really good pilot"? Oh, what's the exact line? You've seen it twice. Yeah. He sees the X-Wing doing all this stuff. He doesn't go, "Awesome." He goes, "That's a good pilot." Who are you talking to?
Talking to himself.
Who does that?
Why did he do them different from the other pilot?
He was, I don't know. I loved the hilarity of Finn taking his helmet off, basically going, I'm Finn, I'm here to rescue you. I'm FNN, here to rescue you. It was almost exact, right?
Yeah.
And then he goes, "Why? Oh, you don't have a pilot." Perfect. They both need each other to get out. That's all great. But, oh my God, they don't show the crash? I really wanted to see the crash. I mean, you can show anything now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anything in the movie can be shown. But I know they do it for storytelling because Finn has to wake up so that Poe is already gone. Because mm-hmm. Poe landed, you know, 50 feet away or something. Well, yeah, I don't know.
They want the illusion that he's dead.
Yeah, I get that. But for no reason. Like, we know he's not dead. He's on all the toys. Right. You know what I mean? You can't have...
So was Darth Maul.
He was in the whole movie. Yeah. He doesn't die the last 5 minutes. That's well. Okay. Here's a better example. Revenge of the Fallen. Optimus Prime dies 20 minutes in. And we're like, well, we know he's not dead. So what do we get? Oh, we get 2 hours with no Optimus Prime. So he can show up at the end. Optimus Prime. Great. We knew you were coming back. But now we just had to endure a whole movie of just Shia LaBeouf. So that's the kind of thing I'm irritated by. We know Poe Dameron ain't dead. He's on all the toys. Of course he's going to show up at the end. And that moment of the bro thing of keep my jacket was like... Somebody at work was like, how much better would Poe Dameron have been if he said... Give me my freaking jacket back, man.
Hilarious.
Get your own jacket.
I thought that was weird, too, because they're hugging and everything, like they're long friends. You just met the guy 10 minutes ago.
You don't even know the guy, right?
Whoa, but you hurtled through space together. Come on.
History? Brotherly.
Look, I've flown with a lot of people. I didn't want to hug them when the end of the flight was over. I'm just kidding, Ryan.
There's no history.
Yeah, but no, guys don't do that. Guys don't do that.
I came off of a space station and hurtled into a planet with the dude that I escaped with,
but listen.
And then he was dead, and then he was not, I'd be like, dude, what? Yeah,
he
totally.
But he should have been like, you can't text a guy, let me know you're okay?
Star Wars, there's no such
thing. They got flash drives, they must have texting. These go part and parcel together.
Oh, really? Well, yeah.
They have little walkie-talkies that are made out of razors. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah.
But that's a walkie-talkie. Can only go so far. If I'm talking about flash drive, they could have emailed in the map.
That's what I can't figure.
R2-D2's in the cloud.
There's
somewhere.
No cloud service in the Star Wars universe. There's no email, no nothing. It must physically get from one part of the galaxy to the other. Physically get there.
Yes.
Well, that makes sense because at the speed of light, it would take forever to get there. You have to go through hyperspace.
Okay, so there's a line of dialogue. Help me out. Where Kylo Ren says, "We've already got most of the map. How did they get most of the map?"
I don't think they ever say.
No, there's a line of dialogue where he only needs that piece. If he has that piece, he can get to Luke and kill him.
It was something along the lines of going through
the records, right? But how does R2 know where he went? Did Luke go, look, I gotta go, here's where I'm going?
Except because he's cowered down and covered with a drape and not been meant to do anything forever, but to just be introspective.
But at the end of the movie, he comes back to life like E.T., and he's got all the information they need. That's what I can't figure out.
Well, because BB-8 walks up and is like, I'm the map holder.
I'm legitimately
asking. I've got your map.
Because, again, if we talk conjecture and drama, isn't the better choice that the bad guys get the map and they go and they nearly kill Luke, and by the time Rey shows up, Luke's like, I gotta go with you. These guys know where I'm at now.
Well, yeah, but that's a different movie. But... With what it was that we were given, it still made sense because of the fact that R2-D2 was sitting there in, I guess, sleep mode. They closed the laptop. Whatever.
Yeah. He has a screensaver on.
Yeah, exactly. The Star Wars.
But I don't understand plot-wise how it all fits that he's got 90% of the map.
Well,
I don't understand that.
But at the same time, you also accept...
Did Luke do that?
I would assume so, because we see Luke with
his hand on it. Yeah,
exactly.
The map is like if you're given a drawing of an island and saying, this is where he is. And like, I have no idea where on Earth this is. And then the other guy has a map that's the Earth with a little cutout of where the island should be. And you need both together to get the full context.
And miraculously, here's
the thing, and this is why it doesn't hold up to scrutiny. A guy who wants to vanish doesn't leave behind a map.
But he knew Rey was going to grow up.
No. But he doesn't... You don't leave that behind. Yeah. You don't leave your PIN number at the ATM. You take it with you. That's what I can't figure out.
I don't think it's ever said how they got the piece. That weird guy in the village
They don't have
missing thing there.
You just have to do like Mon Mothma. Many Bothans died and we got it. Mm-hmm. Problem solved. I'm okay with that.
But it had to be made.
But why was it made?
Yeah.
Right. Luke, why did Ming the Merciless have it?
Luke put it somewhere. That's
Max von Sydow for those.
Yes, he put. Basically, it's a thing of like he put it somewhere for the right person to find. Yeah.
Most likely, he gave it to the old guy who would live and watch Rey.
That's why Obviously, it should have been Wedge.
He didn't do it for
the
some
one
reason.
Guy he trusts. Should have been Wedge. Hell, it should have been Lando. Imagine if the tent opens and Lando's like, I got that for you. I mean, a guy that can get things is Lando Calrissian.
He could have done that. Why didn't they sign him to do it?
I don't know. That's a good question. I have no idea. Mm-hmm. All right, any other threads that we're worried about? We talked about Poe Dameron, who's able to blow. What did they call the weak spot on the Death Star?
I want to say something.
It had a name.
It's like an oscillator.
Oscillator? Was it the oscillator? Generator oscillator? Something, make a circuit with me?
Yeah.
Yeah. I know they couldn't call it an exhaust port. Right. They simply...
they had a trench to it.
They had a trench, and you could just see Kazan going, we need something to call it besides an exhaust port.
One of the things I didn't like was like, it's so similar to the Death Star deal. Yeah,
you know?
Down a trench, gun shooting, come on.
Gotta turn off the shield.
Yeah.
I almost expected trenches? Hardware Wars with like the tractor.
Rey basically did when she pulled that thing down and crawled in it. What was that?
Oh, she just went in the machinery? Yeah. I thought she was going to get squashed.
Yeah.
I was like, I wouldn't go in there.
How about the big monster?
Where
the monster on
there? I actually enjoyed the Han Solo scene of him getting boarded by the two parties.
Because
it was like, we've never seen Han smuggle.
I
thought that was good.
Yeah, I liked it.
You know, I thought, it's the Firefly moment of the show, right?
It kind of reminded me when the monster took him, it was like kind of reminiscent of Aliens. You know, when he's going down and she's looking.
Oh, yeah, no, it was very similar, yeah. You know, when they take Newt.
Yes.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
It reminded me of that.
Yeah, no, I thought that was okay. I enjoyed that part.
As soon as they said there were monsters on board.
Well, you know they're going to get loose.
I don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah, but that's just right up. Set up, cause, reaction. There's nothing you can do about that. Otherwise, you go, where'd the monsters come from? You have to have a dialogue with, we've been hunting them or whatever it is, you know. Yeah. I thought that was okay. I mean, we've seen Minox and Space Slugs, so why, whatever they were, it looked to me like the Beholder from Dungeons and Dragons. That's old school.
I know what you're talking about.
Anyway, you probably Pokemon. it's like Pokemon. Okay, so any other threads we're worried about? I really like the scene in the fake cantina where the one girl goes, call the rebels, they're here, and then the hot chick goes, call the bad guys, they're here. Like, okay, you know, that's it was Casablanca almost. Yeah. Like, they're all here. Everybody's in the same club. Let's do it. I thought that was okay. I enjoyed that. You know? Austin?
When Finn says the two smugglers are gonna smuggle him off the edge of the galaxy, he says, leave him. The two smugglers, like the guy in the helmet that's really cool character design and the little short guy, are holding hands together. Like, although a couple, what's these two story?
Well, you know what? It's funny you bring that up, because I really like that sequence where Finn's like, look, I don't need this, I'm out of here.
Yeah.
And he's literally walking out the door.
She goes down and does the lightsaber thing. When they cut back, he's still going off with them.
Well, time is malleable in this universe, because I told this to somebody today who goes, Jeff, you're just nitpicking. The Rebel base goes, they're going to fire the laser in 2 minutes. Now, we've just seen everybody in the bunker watching Han fall, and when he goes 2 minutes later, they're like a half mile away. Would they sprint? These are you have to take this into account. I mean, and it took like 6 weeks for that thing to power up. Oh my god! You know, you almost expected the status bar to be on the screen. All right, there's a lull here. Anybody got anything else? Or we need to wrap up, Ruslan?
There was something that I noticed firsthand when I was watching the movie was where I don't know if I took this as from the prequels when. Chancellor Palpatine was talking to Anakin about Darth Plagueis, saying Darth Plagueis the Wise. And there is a scene where General Hux says, you know, what are we going to do here? Who are we going to explain this to? And Kylo Ren says, General Snoke, he's wise. So I don't know if I'm reading
Snoke. Oh, right, no.
There's the first time you mentioned Snoke in all the 2 hours.
There's a lot of things about who Snoke is. And let me tell you. Yeah. Out of the whole movie, my least favorite part of the whole movie was that stupid CGI character. If you're not going to tell me who he is, he's got power over everybody. For God's sake, turn to the camera and let us. Who is he?
I don't know. It's something from The Hobbit. Yeah. That big.
Well, it's Andy Serkis, so yeah, it is something from The Hobbit. Yeah, it's the same guy.
Zero information.
My take on it, like, it's just speculation. They got Luke's lightsaber, they got Luke's hand, and that's Luke.
Yeah.
That's a clone, a bad, dark clone of Luke. That's my weirdo thing. And that, or somebody else at work, said, you know, he's just a hologram. We thought he was really big.
Right.
But, he's like Yoda. He's like Yoda size.
So funny.
Yeah, when they finally get in, he's like little Yoda size with a big,
behind the curtain.
I mean, it's that. I agree with you. That's probably for me the weakest part, just because it's there's nothing that happens there.
Nothing that happens. No stakes. And to me, totally cribbed from Battlestar Galactica.
Right.
If you've ever seen Battlestar Galactica, the Cylons go in, and there's a guy in a big chair who turns around, and it's like, what have you done? Well, we're here to tell you this happened. Well, make sure it doesn't happen again, and he turns back around, and you're like, that's from Battlestar Galactica, that big guy in a chair.
Yeah, I mean, nerd! The only reason I kind of let it slide is because, again, it's not a standalone, it's the first act.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I'm sure at some point we're going to see some sort of resolution on it. Yeah. It will
but
be.
If I know, and I get that they're sitting down to write a universe.
Right.
They're not sitting down to write a movie. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a universe. Mm-hmm. Star Wars was written first as a universe and then as a movie.
Right.
And the only thread left hanging is Darth Vader spinning off into space. Mm-hmm. Everything else at Star Wars is tied up in a bun. It's beautiful.
Shay, let me ask something. Now, as far as Luke's saber, that's a different saber than the one that he has in Jedi when he loses his hand. Huh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's the one he loses in Empire, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, no, it's the Empire Strikes Back. It's the Anakin Skywalker one from Mustafar. Mustafar?
Mustafar.
Mufasta? Where's it from?
Well, he had it on Geonosis, too.
Yeah, right. The last time he has it, Obi-Wan picks it up out of the dirt.
Yeah.
We know that because Rick McCallum said they had to go back and film it because Lucas forgot. They're editing the movie and they're like, we don't have him picking up the saber. Oh, well, we kind of need that.
Wait. So, they really did have episode 3 Obi-Wan in the movie. I can't believe they did that. I thought they were going to try and please stay away from the prequels, but they did it. And you know
it's
what?
In that scene.
Yes. I kind of applaud to them.
It's a movie.
And making it connect. So.
Look at you applauding with gloves on. Yeah. It's a movie that, for all its weirdness and... We have issues with it. We love it. We hate it. We love it. We hate it. It does beg to be seen again.
Mm-hmm. I want to see it.
So that you can step back. You know, the only Star Wars movie I've only seen once is Attack of the Clones. That's it. I saw it one time in the theater. We bought the disc and I tried. And I was like, I can't do it. I simply cannot. It's so burned into my head. Every sequence, I have to leave. And I cannot watch that movie. This one, I didn't have any of those. I felt kind of ill at the end because of the New Hope echoes that just kept slamming again and again and again, but it won't keep me from watching it again. I'll watch it again. I won't pay full price because I'm cheap, but I'll watch it again just so that the newness is off. The first time you ride a bike, you're wobbly. So you need that second time to have a little more confidence. And, okay, I'll go to the bathroom at a different time and see what I missed, that sort of thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's Star Wars. Yeah. At the end of the day, like I said...
I only need to rewatch 2 minutes.
Well, I thought it was...
I want to freeze flame and look at all the aliens in the background. That's what I want to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
I also thought it was better in 2D thing. Than 3D.
I would probably agree with you. And that's a lot to do with... A brightness, because 3D movies, because the lenses are polarized, they're all so dark.
3D is all about the ooh ah of everything flying around.
It was worth it to see
the story.
Opening scroll in 3D.
That was pretty cool. I'll give you that. But there are many times I lift the glasses and there's no difference.
Right.
It's just people talking. There's nothing. There's no difference here. I don't know why. Why did I pay extra for this? You know.
One thing, and it's such a minor little thing, but it makes me smile. I like the fact that the lightsabers gave off light finally. I know they tried to do they tried to do it in 2.
I know what you're saying.
Badly. But
well, how about the fact that he put it in the snow and it reacted to the snow?
Yes.
There was
that
a lot
was cool.
There was a lot of tender thought put to lightsaber mechanics. I'll give him that. Yeah. And I appreciated every second of it. I wish they could go back to Clones and have that shot of Obi-Wan in the rain and have it sizzling the water off. I mean, that's what we want. Yeah. We want it to look like it's really it really exists.
Oh, yeah. When he got burned by the hilt in that fight, I was actually really, really happy about that.
Well, because they used it. Yeah. It wasn't just eye candy.
Yeah, exactly. Because I liked it.
I liked how it was jagged and it was very...
It was rough.
Yeah, it was rough, and it was like cool to look at. It was really cool.
And you could hear it. It's in the sound effects. When you listen to all of the other lightsabers, there's a very distinct sound that they make. And then with his, there's like a crackling.
I want to know the story. I want to know his backstory on...
Oh, you'll get it.
Well, himself,
that's you know? We're gonna meet and we're gonna know all about Kylo Ren.
This is the source
in a year and a half from now.
Well, I like that actor.
So next Christmas we get Rogue One, Squadron, or Rogue One,
Rogue One,
which is the story of how the Rebels got the Death Star plans.
Right.
It's a heist movie.
Oh, okay.
I'm okay with that. And then Episode 8 is May, right?
Year and a half.
So we're only a year and a half out. I mean, it's weird because all of us old guys are like, man, 3 years.
Yes,
you watch it and go. I mean, we didn't know at the time. At the end of Empire, 3 years.
3 years. I told Hannah that. I go, you have no idea how long that was.
But here's the thing. We knew that in 2 years, they would re-release the movie. Right. And if you stayed till the credits ended, you got a trailer.
Yes.
And the first time I saw that trailer for Return of the Jedi, my mind was warped.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
And it kept you going until it came out.
Yeah. Now, the Empire trailer is not very good. That's the one with Harrison Ford.
With the Force
Return back to Star Wars. Luke Skywalker.
We went down the line, we watched all the old trailers.
I love the trailers.
The
But the first Jedi one was just like, and like, there was like so six of us because everybody left. And my mom's like, what are you doing? Yeah. I go, just hang on.
I
have a feeling there's going to be something here.
Every time at the end, oh, no, we have to stay.
Well, they re-released Return of the Jedi in 1984 before its home video release, and I sat there and the credits ended and nothing happened. And then the usher asked me to leave. And I mean, did you do that too?
Yeah.
And like, oh, there's no 1986 Star Wars. Oh, Howard the Duck. We get Howard the Duck in 86.
The original Jedi trailer, Luke had a blue saber too.
Did he really?
The trailer, it's blue.
That's before it was, fixed. It was also Revenge of the Jedi before they decided. And George, I don't think Jedi's take revenge, George. Oh, thank you, Mr. Kasdan.
Yes, and now we get, instead of 3 years, we get a year and a half between episodes and a movie.
And a Star Wars movie.
Yeah, I like that.
And multiple TV shows.
And it was it was actually neat taking her and getting in line multiple hours before. It reminded me of when my mom took me and got our chairs and we sat there 5 hours at the Cerritos Twin.
Well, look, you're talking about guys that camped out for a movie they had pre-selected
reserved seats, and we camped 5 days.
Yeah.
5 days?
That's the Star Wars mythos, right? Wow. At the end of the day, we're all just big Star Wars nerds because there are a few things in pop culture that you can cling on to like this. And the weird part about us old guys is that we actually lived through a time when Star Wars went away. And the toy aisle had zero toys.
15 years.
Zero toys, right? And I can remember Rachael and I seeing a magazine, and they advertised the Bendies in the back at one store in San Diego, and I was like, I gotta go.
And then it was the little metal
Action Masters,
yes,
which ironically enough like had no action in them at all. But
or were you just not a master of that action?
They didn't do jack. They were army men.
Yeah.
They were willow figures. But the thing with Star Wars is that we watched it go away, and then since 97.
97
was when the new 95 is when the toys were re-released.
Was it 95?
So 95 is basically Star Wars returned. But there were still lulls where there's no toys. Oh. And now we're at a time where, and it's weird to think, it's never going away. The Target Star Wars aisle will remain the Target Star Wars aisle until I am in the grave. Like, that's weird. That's really weird to think, like, this little movie that we all huddled around the schoolyard has become such ingrained in pop culture that it's not just a toy line, it's an everything line. It's a lifestyle.
Yeah.
Yep. Like, you live the Star Wars lifestyle.
You should see my living
above, like, anybody, I know.
Yeah.
Force Friday, was that what it was called? You bought the big First Order Stormtrooper.
Yeah, it's funny. I mean, growing up, I was all about the figures, and I still have the first figures I got in 78, still to this day.
So do I.
You know, and
I have the bite marks on the end of the saber that I used to chew
and
on.
You know, from then, it's I went up, one came out, I did the same thing, got into the figures, have every single one carded, boxed, whatever. Once episode 2 rolled around, I started drifting away from, and it wasn't, I don't think it was so much because of the movie itself. It was just because figures, one, became a lot more expensive.
Yeah.
They went from, you know, way back when, $2,
mm-hmm.
up to $5, which they stayed at $5 for a long, long time. And then they started going $8, $9, $10, $12. And being a completionist, it was too hard to find.
Yeah, it's too hard, right.
You know, so I kind of gave up on that and started drifting into, like, Sideshow, Channel Giant.
Yeah, you collect the high-end stuff. A lot of collectors are like you, though. And the Attack of the Clones line did it because not only did the price jump a little bit, but they weren't posable anymore.
Right.
The Attack of the Clones line was the first pre-posed, like, in action shot thing. And I'm like, that's not what I want. I want it on my desk, but I want to be able to lift it and be able to do stuff with
it. You know, going into it, I figured the amount of money I'll have to spend to get a line just of the figures, I could get a couple nice, you know, nice 3-4 foot, you know, premium figures and put them on my shelf.
So is the Finn action figure the Rick Ollie of Force Awakens?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He's on every peg.
Oh yeah,
and he's a
regular figure, Black Series, whatever. It's the only.
Isn't that weird? Like, you think now that the movie's out that some of those figures will start to move because everybody wants the bad guy.
Yeah, I think it will.
And isn't that weird? Does that say something about our culture? You know, and I'm sure people go, "Oh, it's a racist thing. They don't want a black figure." I don't care what color the figure is.
What?
He's the good guy. I think it's more about how the marketing for these movies is not about the good guys anymore.
Look at the cards.
It's about the bad guy.
Kylo Ren's on the cards. Kylo Ren's
the packaging.
I thought
Kylo Ren to be more likable than the good guy.
He was.
What the hell's wrong with? He's the bad guy.
It was a good choice. He's a much more likable character than the heroes.
Kylo Ren and Moss. They took the film.
See, to me, I'm agreeing with you that Kylo Ren was the more interesting character, but as far as the movie goes, we as a culture are supposed to gravitate towards the good guys.
Yeah,
the good guys are being oppressed. The good guys are having their freedoms taken away, and they're the ones who say, enough is enough. I'm going to put my life on the line so that you can do what you want.
The good guys didn't do anything.
The good guys are
just
boring.
They just happen to be
that's
standing.
That's it, right? Is that it?
The good guy is in beige.
They happen to be standing there.
Is that it?
They didn't partake in it.
It's a marketing thing. It's a visual thing.
You're right.
Cards, Kylo's on all the cards.
Yeah.
And you look at just, you know, I want a guy in pants and jacket, or I want a guy in black with a hood and a mask with a lightsaber. They're going to
And we've also had 30 years of marketing Darth Vader as the main character. And he's not. Luke Skywalker is the main character. But if you market Luke Skywalker, Mark Hamill gets a check. Darth Vader doesn't get a check.
Right.
Dave Proust hasn't received a dime.
If they had merchandise of old Luke and Han, it'd be different. But they aren't selling that. They won't release an old Han figure, especially now, because no kid's going to buy a damn.
Well, now there's got to be one, right?
Yeah, there is. They're coming.
There has to be an old Han.
Why would they release an old Han after the movie? What's the point
of
that?
Kids are supposed to Darth Maul who died. But they have toys for him and lightsabers.
Well, we walked in on Force Friday and found a Jar Jar figure on the peg, so all bets are off.
You bought all of them, right?
All bets are off.
Was it one of the Mashables?
Yeah. He's the only Jar Jar.
Indy saw one of those in the grocery store, and he's like, I want them. I'm like, go. Leave the store now.
You're no longer my son.
The line is great because I need to get one of those Jurassic World ones and one of the Jar Jar ones.
Pop
and
them
put
together.
The Jar Jar head on the dinosaur. Like,
yeah, that sounds great. Misa abomination. All right, well, we're gonna wrap this up. Any final thoughts on Force Awakens?
I have one thing I want to ask.
Absolutely, it's what we're here for.
I wanted to know what you thought about the score.
Oh, I thought the score was good, but like I said earlier, instead of accompanying the movie, it was triggering the movie. It was every time Rey looked at the camera, it went, na, 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 na. And they only did that once in Star Wars when Luke looked at the sun.
Yeah. Right.
Yes.
This is what you're supposed to be feeling. That's what music is supposed to do.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I've always been a fan, and the one thing I wasn't a fan of with the score for the prequels, and it was the same thing visually, is I felt like it was too busy.
Oh, yeah, sure.
I've been doing it
the whole show. Dun, 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 dun,
yeah,
dun,
it was just, it was, there was so much stuff layered and layered and layered, and this one, and I've been listening to it the last couple of days, just, you know, in wherever I'm driving, and it's, and he definitely went back.
See, I'm not the only one who listens to that kind of stuff
definitely
in the car.
Went back and
nerd!
I do know.
But there's, you know, the one thing that it's a little disappointing is there's not anything that hooks. There's nothing new.
New.
No, hooks. There's yeah, no new. There's no new
but,
score.
I mean, but here's the thing. Here's the thing. Lord of the Rings, Harry Potter are the last movies of art of this new generation to even have a score.
Right.
Spider-Man, he's a great character. Does he have a theme song?
No.
Does yeah. the Nolan Batman have a theme song that you can remember? If I go, I'm doing 1989 Batman. But the new one, nothing memorable. Superman? The new one, mm-hmm. zero.
Right.
They don't do it anymore. Well, it's not part of the film lexicon anymore. Nobody cares. The viable movie score and theme went out with Drew Struzan's posters. Mm-hmm. Photoshop and keyboards replace all of that.
Well,
and that's sad.
Too, the music for this one was done by American musicians, not the London.
So you're saying it was the T.
Yeah. Yeah, Americans did the music for this one.
Yeah,
we're all lazy.
We drink Bud Light.
That's right.
Just in listening to
it. Wait, what's wrong with Bud Light?
Okay, well,
I mean, there's on the soundtrack, and I've heard that Williams did like hours of music that didn't even reach.
Oh, I'm sure. Film. I'm sure.
And,
yeah.
and listening to it, I mean, they have Ray's theme in there, which is actually decent. But in the film, I mean, it's like a touch. You barely get any of it.
Well, here's the problem, though. It has to do with the way movies are made.
Yeah.
This movie didn't ever slow down long enough for a theme.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. You know, again, a scene like Luke looking at the sun is never going to fly in a movie like this.
Yeah.
The closest we got was her eating lunch.
Yeah.
Literally, that's
yeah.
the closest
yeah,
scene.
Yeah, right.
You get her theme in.
That's it.
Yeah.
Oh, there it is. Yeah, I nailed it. That's the one scene where the movie stops so she can have lunch.
Yeah.
And like, I want to be a better person off-world. No, I mean, really? That's it? The gimmick is where she's sitting? I mean, oh my God, Luke Skywalker stared off into his destiny. And the next day, he fulfilled it. Everybody died around him. That's
yeah.
what we want.
Yeah, her son yeah. was looking at the ship taking off. That was her son. That was her twin sons.
That's not good enough.
No. Soundtracks are important.
They
in
saved
movies.
It for, I'm sorry. They saved it for that beauty shot of the TIE fighters against the sun.
Yeah.
You know? That was the equivalent.
You're so right about that, though, with them ending soundtracks. I mean, I remember as a kid collecting things. I had the Goonies album.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
The Goonies soundtrack.
Well, they have them now, but they go like, music from and inspired by.
Yeah.
And you're like, I mean, how many of us bought the Batman soundtrack, got home, and found it was all Prince songs?
Yeah, exactly.
And you're like, where's the music? What the hell is this?
Yeah.
There was two of them.
Yeah. I know. I had to wait. And the guy's like, oh, you're one of those. Here you are. Here you are, sir.
You're looking at the whole package, though. I mean, as a movie fan.
Oh, yeah. Well, we all had the Star Wars soundtrack.
Yeah.
And the record, it was part of our life. We carried around with us.
Yeah.
I had the Star Wars Adventure when R2-D2 beeps, turn the page. The music was what
yes.
sold us
oh
on
my
that.
God. Yes.
And my Vader printed vinyl, The Story of Star Wars.
Yeah, with that money shot of him with the red saber, right? The
mm-hmm.
beautiful, yeah.
Yep.
At least we got better than the Star Trek music.
Sabotage.
Yeah,
well, the least said about that, the better. Any final Star Wars thoughts? This has been fantastic. You guys are all amazing to sit and talk about Star Wars like this. We've delved into it all, haven't we? Have we left any stone unturned?
The video game sucked.
Video game? No tie-ins.
The Force Awakens?
Yeah.
Cool. It's Battlefront.
Right. On Jakku when you're creating
the Jakku. What about the Star Tours level? Did you do that yet?
Oh, we haven't done that yet.
If you go to Star Tours, no matter what you get on the bookends,
uh-huh.
you get Jakku in the middle.
Oh, really?
And BB-8 is always the hologram. And you know what?
Thanks for ruining that, Jeff.
Sorry. Spoiler alert. All right, so we're gonna wrap up here. Austin, if we have to cut to that, Austin asked, if we saw Star Wars The Force Awakens again, would we like it less or more? And the consensus is you probably like it a lot more. Once the pressure of the first night's viewing is off, and I paid $100 for the tickets and $45 at the concession stand, and it was a lot of work to get to that and stress, and if I went to a matinee where I walked up and snuck in a Frappuccino, I would probably enjoy it a hell of a lot more.
Yeah.
So we'll do that, and Rachel will stay awake.
At least those 2 minutes.
It's ironic you fell asleep in a movie called The Force Awakens. So, what does the title mean, you guys? We know what A New Hope is. We know what The Striking Back is and The Return of the Jedi.
It's Rey. It's about Rey.
It's Rey.
The Force Awakening inside of her.
She's the Force Awakening in her.
That's what I got from it.
It's about R2-D2 waking up. Star Wars, the droid awakens. And just so you know, just so you guys know, they were joking the other day. We bought this DVD at Best Buy, R2-D2 Under the Dome. No, no. Like, have you ever watched this thing?
I know.
It's unwatchable. It's a 30 or 40 minute.
Well, I think they did it when I was up there. I want to say.
It's not funny. It's not enjoyable. Right? It's a mockumentary about R2-D2 being a jerk-off.
Yeah.
And it literally makes you hate him and everybody involved in the movie, especially the fight coordinator from the three prequels. Oh, I hate him from that. And there's already a BB-8 documentary on the internet. There's already. Somebody already made it. BB-8 this, BB-8 that. Wah, wah, wah. Brian will be the first one to watch it.
Oh, I can't wait.
Do you like Bill Hader?
Oh, yeah.
You know who Bill Hader is? Mm-hmm. He was Fear in Inside Out. He was on SNL. He was in, did you see Paul? He was really good in Paul.
Skeleton Twins.
He's the voice of BB-8.
Train wreck.
He's the voice of...
So what you're saying is the last movie that we talked about where I was like, I really don't like this movie. You're saying that somebody in that movie is the character that I don't like in this movie.
I know. It's a subliminal connection.
It's weird.
You hate Bill Hader.
That's what it is.
We should really...
Guys, that's what this entire podcast has been about. 3 hours. Brian hates Bill
Hader. Brian, the hate awakens. We got it.
You've discovered your hate.
All right. Yes. Shay, how many times are you going to see the movie in the theater?
I've seen it twice. We saw it twice. The first night. I'm going to see it Wednesday at 9 a.m.
Yeah.
Which
one have you seen in the theater the most? It's got to be New Hope. No, probably Empire.
Do we count special editions?
Yeah. Because that's the only opportunity you and I had with our own money to go see it.
Yeah, I mean, I'd probably say Jedi, just because I was older and my mom would drop me off and watch it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because, I mean, on release, I saw Jedi probably 5 or 6 times in the theater.
Yeah, me too.
Because
it was the first time I was able to say, I want to go to the movies. Right. Can you drop me off?
Exactly.
And I got this figure Squidhead. I still haven't seen him in the movie.
Prune-face?
Yeah. I got Prune-face.
You don't see Prune-face.
Yeah, where's Prune-face? I don't know. Rune Marco. They've all got names.
My guess,
you know,
is...
that they named the Cantina band the Jizz Whalers?
Shut up! Knock it off!
I'm not kidding.
Are you joking?
No, I'm not kidding. I didn't make that up.
How could you make up something like that?
I can see that.
Figurin Dan and the Modal Nodes are Jizz Whalers. That is canon. That is canon. That is canon run amok.
Oh, man.
It's a far cry. You know why Nine Numb is named Nine Numb? Because when they gave the character designs over to Kenner, he was number 9. Nine Numb. Sorry to burst your bubble on that.
Wow.
How many times are you going to see it in the theater, Brian? Or are you done?
I will probably go and see it again, and I'll probably once again enjoy it more.
Yeah.
Just because of the fact that I've... more so, for me, it would be something that it's like, I've... Like, again, the hype is over, you're correct, but I've also taken a critical eye to the movie. Like, when I... Because, of course, I, like any stupid person, watched all six... In order, and when I say in order, I mean starting at 1. And so, when I did that, I found a different point of view on the first three movies.
Interesting you say it like that, Brian.
Yeah, well...
A certain point of view.
Yes, exactly. But my point of view was very different from the way that I felt about them initially. And honestly, the way that I felt about Hayden Christensen in the movie was... a little different, but I feel like I'll be able to take that into seeing this movie again.
All right. How many times are you going to see it, Glenn?
Well, I've seen it twice already. I saw it 2 times the first day. I know I'll see it at least once, probably twice.
More. Yeah. Used to be, back in the day, you had a lot more opportunity to see these movies. The first Star Wars movie played over a year in theaters. This one is going to be, it's December. We're going to see Force Awakens on Blu-ray and DVD April. May?
Probably May.
May at the latest?
Yeah.
You can already pre-order it. We
There's no date. You can just give them your money. All
yeah, but May.
All the theaters are whatever their largest. I mean, similar to how they've done before. Whatever their largest theater they put it in, it's obligated for 4 weeks. In that
yeah, we've already heard Tarantino yelling about this. Oh, so stupid. God. He's such an idiot. Yes.
Well, back in the day, movies were $5 too, so it was easy to go see them.
Yeah. Not so much now. Yeah. You go to the theater. What movie? I'm just making a payment on the last one. Hello, Jeff. You're going to see it with him a few more times, right?
Yes. Yeah, all right. Probably 4 times in the theater.
Oh, that's good. Ruslan, you going to see it again?
Probably maybe 4 or 5 times. Maybe. I don't know.
Well, listen, Disney's a small, independent studio, and they really need your support. So
I mean, they just opened this Pixar thing.
We all need to do our part.
I mean, it's all a test.
Colleen, you going to take him to theater a bunch more times?
I'll take him as many times as you want.
See, that's a mom right there. What about you two, frickin' frack here?
I'll see as many times as you want.
Yeah. So you're not going to see it again?
You said want.
Yeah, no, we're going to go again.
It's a Star Wars movie. Like you said, all in all, it's a Star Wars movie.
Right. Yeah. I use a bad analogy.
And look,
if you're having sex, even bad sex is better than a good day at the office. Okay? He just is ignoring me. It's usually about fishing. Even the bad day of fishing is better than a good day at the office. Star Wars.
Times.
What?
I watched Attack of the Clones multiple
times. Yeah, well, your skull hadn't fully hardened yet, so.
I thought the
Clones was good. Austin has so many Star Wars horror stories of him getting caught up. Like, there's a character called CZ4. Do you even know who CZ4 is?
Give us the lowdown.
He's the robot in Mos Eisley that walks around sort of with a twitch. Right? And in a lot of scenes of the movie, he's in pieces.
The white one?
Yes.
Okay.
Austin was obsessed with this character for like 9 months when the action figure was announced. And we had to pay a scalper, what, $30 for this figure?
Yeah, the collectible stop.
Yeah.
This happened over and over again. I get hooked on these aliens.
Yeah.
And the one time I think myself is the concept of a Fett figure, I had good taste.
Concept Boba Fett.
I had good taste for that one.
Yeah.
The Flesman's guy, not so much.
Yeah. That's Worm Loathsome from the Clone Wars movie.
The one who sits down and has tea with Obi-Wan for like
minutes. Let's not talk about that. But also, you had a character. You took the McQuarrie Stormtrooper concept.
Yes, I did. Gave him
a shield and a lightsaber and basically invented Captain Phasma before Captain Phasma.
My storyline when I was little is I always wanted to be Fordo in the storyline. I would never go backwards. I thought that was terrible. So my idea was...
So you didn't want to do a prequel.
No, my idea was a new Empire, and I got the McQuarrie Stormtrooper. And I was like, well, this guy would make a great Imperial Commander. So I named him Lucky as, like, his code name. And he was Lucky, and he was Lucky Trooper, the Stormtrooper with a cape that led the new Imperial Army. They took my idea.
They took your ideas.
Why out of me?
Yeah, and gave her no scenes.
Gave her no scenes, too.
Made her a woman, cut her out of the movie. What the hell?
Woman.
It's irritating. It's irritating to think here, terrible example. There's a new Ghostbusters movie in quotes coming out next summer, and if you say you don't like it, you are misogynist. You are against women. I'm talking about Star Wars, and the character I want to see the most of is the woman.
Yeah.
I want Captain Phasma in 50% of the movie. I want, like, every time they open a door, there's Captain Phasma again, beating everybody up. That's what I want. Are you kidding? I love that actress. I love the character. And they don't give me enough. And so I'm the misogynist because I don't like Melissa McCarthy as a Ghostbuster.
Online, there's bull. Like, you're a horrible person if you didn't like Ray.
I didn't like Ray because Ray was boring. That's the problem. Doesn't matter what sex, color, creed. I don't care.
At least
make
Finn
her interesting.
Was funny.
Finn had great lines. Finn was funny when he's begging BB-8 to take him to the Rebel base. That was funny.
Yeah. He was real.
He was a real person. When he rescues Poe, not because he's a good guy, not because they're beating him up. He needs a pilot to get out.
Yeah.
That told me a lot. That's how you do a character quick and make you like him. I get it. Poe was very likable. Not Poe, Finn. But that being said, in every other instance, a lightsaber slash to the back is a death wound.
Yeah.
Right?
He's not going to be back for the third movie.
Every time they fight, you get a ding with that saber, you are out. Finn gets it right up the back, and he's just, it's still here.
Yeah, did you hear them?
What?
Kylo took one to the face.
He should be dead.
Yes, he should be dead.
Yeah. I wanted Ray to go. If any of my limbs or organs will help, I'll gladly donate them.
Yeah,
he'll be just fine.
Those who've seen it twice. Does Kylo lose his arm?
I thought he lost a hand.
No.
Dark Vader.
No.
Something falls next to
him. All he lost was my respect for not winning that fight.
No, the
last thing they want to do in a movie trying to distance themselves from George Lucas is have somebody lose a limb, okay?
Beat himself like a monkey.
He's McConaughey.
Can we have a note for the next movie? When are they going to reveal that Plo Koon survived the Sith quest?
Can I tell you? That was revealed today.
What?
They already revealed that Plo Koon will be in the next movie. I'm not
what?
Joking.
Oh my God.
I'm not joking.
You're serious?
I'm totally serious. You can Google it.
Are they bring Boskin?
What's the site name?
What's the what?
Site name.
I'll watch the movie again. I'll wait for the next one.
Oh, just I go to all the movie sites. They've already said that.
But George Lucas promised.
Okay. George Lucas is out of the picture, man.
When Dave Filoni was making,
you'll shoot your eye out, kid.
When Dave Filoni was consulting for Rebels, right before Disney bought them, he told George, "I'm gonna put Plo Koon in the Rebel Alliance and basically retcon what you did." And George Lucas told him, "If you show Plo Koon joining the Rebel Alliance, I will re-release Revenge of the Sith with a more death scenes of Plo Koon. It will be more violence."
Why would he do that? Well, I don't know. But no, I think the gist of the article was that you will see the return of some of the other characters from the Star Wars universe. Plo Koon was mentioned specifically, which I thought was interesting.
So Mace Windu's going to be in Yoda's house.
Mace,
thank
yeah.
you.
Yeah.
Everybody put your shoes on.
Yes.
Have a great day.
You see Mace Windu? I've had it with these snakes in this Yoda house.
Please. I'm sorry, my biggest problem with episode 3 is Samuel L. Jackson didn't yell enough in it.
Yeah, well, he also got taken out like a bitch. He totally did. Whole room full of Jedi.
And that's the reason why I'm like, he ain't dead.
Yeah, a whole room full of Jedi, and they're out in a second. Lightsaber. Yeah, no, that's not, we don't need to do any prequel stuff. We're going to wrap this up.
Wait,
yeah.
No, wait. If Maz is 1,000 years old, does that mean Maz is going to be edited into the prequels?
She's older than Yoda.
No, they're not going to go back and do a special edition.
Yeah,
right?
Special edition.
No, can you imagine? Imagine if there was a guy sitting in a room somewhere, and every time they rearrange Star Wars chronology, he's got to re-edit the movies. Like, I want to meet that guy. Oh, what'd you do? Oh, I put Hayden Christensen in Return of the Jedi. I hate myself. What are you doing now? I'm putting Maz in the Cantina. Like, retcon everything, you know? Like, Star Wars is a Rubik's Cube that just keeps changing and moving, and the colors never match up. So, all right. Well, hey, I want to thank everybody for coming over and hanging out. This has been the most fun ever doing an episode with everybody yelling and this. And I mean, that's what fandom is about. And can you think... anybody, is there a single fandom this vibrant that could have a conversation this amazing?
Star Trek.
Not anymore. It would be 30 minutes of sabotage.
Me, but it would only be like me and three people.
Yeah, no, V is not a... You
me
V?
Either, but I'm ready for it. Let's do it. I'd be part of that.
All right.
I got some video games.
Video games.
They're trying to turn Harry Potter into that by doing more stuff.
Yeah, Harry Potter. No,
Oh my God, wasn't that trailer great?
Oh, yeah. I wish we'd gotten that in 3D. At least I would have, you know. So we're going to wrap this up. Let's go around, everybody say goodbye. And if you have anything to plug or a website or a business, Shay?
I have nothing to plug. I'm just here as a fan. And if anybody wants to find me, chances are I'll be at Big Newport on Friday night.
There you go.
Bang.
Brian?
Oh, yeah, I do. I'm Brian. You can find me on YouTube and Twitch at SuperToken, SuperToken. I play lots of weird games and usually say stupid things in front of a camera.
How many people watch you when you play a game? A lot, right?
It depends, and yes.
I'm amazed at that.
That's a different podcast.
Yeah, it is.
we'll talk, but yeah, it's honestly, it's a lot of fun. The shortest version of that is it takes what people used to love about getting all of your friends together and sitting in front of your Super Nintendo. It takes that thing and puts it on the internet. All
right.
Oh, Glenn, I got nothing to plug, really, but...
You have a business? What do you do?
I sell espresso machines, which has got nothing to do with more.
If we'd had one, Rachel would have stayed awake.
Yeah.
Hey, I can drink three pots of coffee in a row and still not stay awake.
Yeah, I know.
Me too.
All right.
You did good by missing that scene.
Julie, just thanks for having us.
This is the greatest. Are you kidding?
I got nothing. Thank you for having me.
Am I the only one? Oh, my God.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Luna, something to plug?
Don't you
play online doing something?
I make things sometimes. I'm on a low right now. I'm working.
Okay.
I'm part of a podcast called 90 Will Be Seen. Oh, and also, Plo Koon's coming back.
Plo Koon's coming. Yeah, is it? I have to say, Austin is such a big Plo Koon fan that when we were watching the news for the premiere of Sith at the Cinedome, that we were so excited, like about 6 o'clock, 5 o'clock news. I said, let's just go. Let's just go down there. We don't even have tickets. We'll just go. So we drove all the way down there, and there's all these people in costumes and this, and there was a guy dressed as Plo Koon, and Austin's hugging him and loving him, and he leaned down to Rachel, and he goes, don't let him see the movie. Yeah, Plo Koon gets blown up.
Oh, no.
And I'm like, we're seeing it tomorrow. Oh, my God. You know, it was a really, really funny moment. I mean, what a nice guy. He's like, you know, he leans down. Somebody goes, hold my saber. Opens the man. Listen. Don't take your son to see the movie. You know what I mean?
Don't do it. It'll be
so. All right. Rachel?
I have nothing to plug. Hire me. Give me a job.
Yeah.
Anytime I can get it out there. I'm looking for a day job so I can be home with my baby.
Okay.
Booyah.
Oh, thank you for having me.
Hannah, come on. Plug something. What are you into? What do you do? Don't you play sports?
Yeah.
What do you do?
I play softball.
Yeah? What position?
Give a shout out to your team.
I don't have a team right now.
Oh,
she's in between teams.
All right.
She's also a percussionist, very cool vibes player.
Yeah.
Look
how modest you are.
Yeah.
All right, how about you?
Boaz. That's all I got to plug.
I'm Boaz.
I'll be around for a while.
I like to role play at a Charles Dickens Christmas Carol.
Yeah. Oh my God.
I know a guy, his name's Hal. Last name's Jalika Kick.
Hal Jalika Kick.
Hal Jalika Kick.
All right. And you all know who I am. If you listen to this show, you know me. I'm Jeff. Thanks for tuning in. You can follow us on, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter. Check out our Patreon page and support the show if you want. You couldn't ask as a Star Wars fan for a better Christmas present. And I told the family going in, I feel really weird because normally this is a summertime thing. I'm completely thrown off. My entire lifetime, Star Wars is a summer thing. The special editions don't count. Going to see a new one was summer. When we leave, it's hot. This Christmas thing is weird, but I did listen to another podcast, the Cracked Podcast, where they had read a report that because winter is cold and people stay inside more, people are more nostalgic around Christmas time. So that's why we're seeing this huge, I mean, it's part of it, massive welcome back to Star Wars, because few franchises can go away or survive the prequels and come back and be welcomed like this. This doesn't happen every day, folks. So if you're on the fence, go see Star Wars The Force Awakens on the big screen so you have something to talk about at the water cooler. Don't be the guy at the office plugging his ears, la, 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 Tim Klega, I'm looking at you, because Monday morning, all bets are off. You've had a weekend to see it. Those of us that went to see it have no sympathy for those that didn't, right?
Yeah.
Right. So I'm Jeff Tucker. Thanks for tuning in. If this show was a stormtrooper and had its own code name, the code name would be what? 91 Reasons!
For listening to 91 Reasons. Please subscribe and leave a review on iTunes. Find us on Facebook. Is anyone even still listening?